And what's going on, guys? Welcome back to another episode of Schmodown Backstage here on SEN. My name is Ben Bateman. Today, I'm going to be talking to you guys about all kinds of crazy matches from the last week. We had incredible wins, incredible losses. It's a very exciting time to be a part of the Schmodown, but I can't do it myself. I cannot do it myself. I do it with the help of my co-host, with my faction mate, one of the greatest players that has ever played the game. You know him as the Outlaw, Mr. John Steven Rocha, joins the show with me right now. How you doing, John?
I'm good. I'm out of breath. I had to run over from the SEN Live studios, now here in the Schmodown Backstage studios, so I'm a little out of breath. Excited, I just kind of jumped up and grabbed some lunch and jumped up. I'm ready, dude. So many great matches, you know, so many things are happening in the Schmodown. These tournaments have really taken on a life of their own, Ben, and I'm excited to talk about so many of the matches that we had and get a chance to interview some of the competitors that were involved in these matches as well. It's a great time to be a Schmodown fan, man.
You know, John, I guess I didn't even realize, I didn't register you were over at the SEN Live studios this morning. Was it a whole group of people in there or just you in there?
Yeah, we were trying to simulate what it's been like in the studio before we went on to the COVID break, obviously. And thanks to RB3 and him running it through Zoom, we were able to get the audio for the intro to the show, got Schmobots going. Everything was going really well. So I feel like we had a really great episode of the show, and the fans are so great to watch and donate as much as they did. And then tomorrow we'll be back again, all five of us, quote unquote, the Monday crew, back together again to host SEN Live. So it's going to be a lot of fun, definitely.
Excellent, man. That's awesome. Well, guys, today we have a full show for you. We have great guests coming up today. We've got Molly Damon. We've got Alex Damon. We've got Brandon Hitman Hannah. And, of course, we have Joseph Scrimshaw. A lot of things to talk about. So Star Wars matches were crazy. IG is taking off. But remember, if you guys have any questions for the competitors you see on the show today for the pros, be sure to send your Streamlabs and your Super Chats in. SEN is a network that is run pretty much purely off that stuff. So it means everything to us when you guys do that. There's a bunch of matches dropping this week we're going to talk about, some of which are on Patreon right now. You guys can go to patreon.com/theschmodown. You get access to everything early. And of course, go follow us on Twitch, because the Star Wars tournament right there is exclusive to Twitch. If you go follow on Twitch, you guys get to watch these matches live. We have, obviously, Ken Knapsack versus Andres Ace Cabrera tomorrow live. And these live Star Wars matches have been insane, John. I mean, absolutely insane. Our first guest today coming up in just a couple minutes is going to be Molly Damon, talking about one of those very matches. If you could have seen, guys, watching this, if you could see the Finstock Exchange group chat when we were all watching when we were watching that Dimolanta match, it was crazy. It was just like all capitals, all exclamation points.
A lot of emojis. I mean, we were just like as much as we all like to talk and, you know, believe in our play, it's when you see a match like this, you kind of step away from all of that and you go back to being a fan and you're watching two incredible competitors go toe to toe and fight to the end. And it was, I mean, we've never seen this before, Ben, what I consider to be two perfect games. We've never seen two perfect games in a match and what it led to, obviously. And I thought, in my opinion, it was the perfect ending. Both men get to walk away with their head held high. Both competitors, rather, get to walk away with their head held high in this competition. And we are the better for having watched such a titanic battle between Scrimshaw and Dimolanta.
There's a lot of very talented players in this tournament, and I think the competition is just going to get tighter and tighter as we get closer to the top. I was driving to go run an errand, and I realized, I forgot that that it was going to start right then. And so I pulled over to the side of the road. I stop everything I was doing. I was on a tight time crunch that day trying to run errands, and I sit down with my phone. The AC in my car is barely working. I'm sitting there inside my car just sweating. I don't want to get outside the car and be around people. So I'm just sitting there sweating, watching the matches, and it's just – it was nuts, man. It was an intense experience. But so our very first guest today is a Star Wars competitor, somebody you guys know, a free agent signing recently, and somebody who I think there is a lot of hype as far as how this tournament is going to go with. And that is Molly Damon herself. We've got her coming up right now. Molly, how are you?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
Doing very well. Excited to have you on the show this week.
Yeah, happy to be here.
And you. Look at the size of those freaking headphones. Those are Princess Leia headphones, for God's sake. They're incredible. Look at the size of those things.
I'm in Alex's office. He has better lighting.
I feel like why that's got to be something that exists, right? The Princess Leia headphones, that has to be a product that you can buy.
It should be.
Yeah.
Seems kind of crazy if it's not, actually. I can't believe that. So we saw your first match in the tournament this last week, Molly. And obviously, you know, there was a lot of hype leading up to this one. This is your second match played, right? You had played in a five-way match, is that right?
Yeah, I played a Celebration.
How was it, the difference between being in front of a live crowd, you know, in a five-way versus one-on-one when there's, you know, more pressure, more expectation?
I mean, I feel like there was the same amount of nerves in me to just play well, but I don't know, playing live in front of a ton of just diehard Star Wars fans was pretty intense.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Did anything surprise you about the experience as you were going through it? I mean, because obviously Alex has played some exhibition matches virtually, and I'm sure you've been in the house when that has happened. What did you find to be your toughest thing as you were playing this match, other than obviously your nerves? But what else did you find to be unique about this particular type of match?
I mean, other than the challenges, it felt the same. And like having a manager there was different.
Right on.
Yeah, with the management, the digital management that we've seen has been really, really interesting, right? Like it's a lot of the player conversation that happens is happening via like public. It's like a public forum. There's no private conversation that gets to happen. But I think the role of the manager who, you know, because they're sitting there watching digitally, they feel like one of the major things they can do is to challenge. And Sam Levine, the Inglorious One, is definitely a stickler for the rules.
No shoot.
I had not seen the Scrimshaw Demolanta match when I went on for my match, because I was like, okay, if I watch that, I might, you know, I don't know, like get more nervous. So I was like, I'm going to wait. And then I saw the score and I was like, what? yeah. And then the challenges started flying and I was like, whoa, this is a different kind of game now.
Yeah, were you on board with these challenges, or did you and Sam just kind of jumped in? Were you okay? Did you guys have a conversation ahead of time? Just like, Sam, if you see something, feel free to say something, or Mott, like, was this something you all discussed in terms of strategy before the game started?
No.
That sounds about right for Sam. That sounds about right. Yeah.
I mean, I'm kind of like torn on the challenges, because like some stuff I definitely think the challenges are warranted. Other stuff, yeah, I'm like, eh. So, right.
So in the process of getting ready for this match, obviously this was your debut signed by the Usual Suspects. And I want to know a little bit about that free agency period, because my understanding is there was more than one manager that came after you, and that you got contacted by a few people.
Yeah.
Ultimately, the decision to go with the Usual Suspects, can you walk me through a little bit of that process and kind of what it was like that week?
Sam was one of the first to contact me, and like I talked to Alex about it, and you know, Roxy of course contacted me and was like, come on, man. But yeah, I was like, you know, I'm gonna go with Sam, because he was just really nice, and I was like, I want to be in a separate faction, because eventually I want, like, head to head, like I want to play my husband for this belt.
So that was the biggest determining factor with that, was that you just knew you couldn't be on the same faction. So Roxy was kind of lost before she even started a little bit.
Yeah. I have to say I did maybe string her along for a little bit, but
oh, no.
I was like, I don't know.
it's hard for our players. Go ahead, John.
You know, I'll just say real quick, did Alex have any input in where you were going to go, other than obviously the fact you wanted to play Alex? Did you consult with Alex? Did you talk this out with Alex? Or did you kind of keep your own counsel with this before you made your decision?
I didn't really talk to him about it at all. I was like, yeah, I think I'm going to start playing again. And he was like, oh, okay.
Right.
Wow. Okay. So yeah, you're a little clandestine about this. You've decided to keep it close to the vest.
Yeah.
Okay, that's pretty badass. I like that. I'm excited. I hope. I mean, I don't hope for the sake of our guy, but I hope for the sake of your story and the Schmodown that someday that's the thing you get to do, because I think that would be very exciting for everybody.
Yeah.
You know, and we'll when we bring him in, we'll get to ask this question a little bit. But just from your point of view as a Star Wars competitor, who obviously is as close to the champion as anyone, do you feel like what you're seeing right now, do you feel like the competition out there even has a shot, or do you, not including yourself?
Mm. Definitely. I mean, Alex has only played one perfect game before, I think, and that was the one against Laura Kelly. So, man, Dimelanta and Scrimshaw really brought the game to another level. So, I'd say anyone has a shot at this point.
Yeah, I mean, the game between them was such a, what would you say? It's an it's like an old school Titanic heavyweights all the way to the end.
Yeah.
Yours was more of a hard scrabble, gutted out, just kind of a harder, more tougher victory in that way, because you had to overcome these challenges. You had to come missing a couple of questions. Like it asked more of you, or a different, I guess it asked as much of you, but just in a different way. What was your emotional wave like through this match of yours? Like, were there moments where you're like, okay, I've lost this thing, or no, I might have a shot. No, I think I got this thing. Like, what were the waves like for you throughout this match? Cause there were so many things that were thrown in your way to try to overcome here.
I felt pretty confident the whole time. Once the challenges started happening, I was like, anything could happen at this point. Yeah. If I don't get the answer exactly right down to the word. So I don't know. I didn't feel nervous about that until like after I won, and I was like, oh, okay. So the next game, that's how it's going to be.
Right on. Right on.
Well, I thought that was really interesting, like the sheer number of challenges that we saw in your match, because that's, I mean, I've played a lot of matches in my Schmodown career that I've had zero challenges. You know, I mean, there's more these days. What are you smiling, John? Are you smiling? No,
I'm waiting for you to finish your sentence. I don't recall any zero challenges in your match other than the most recent title match earlier this year. But I know you and Sam are the best at these challenges. You do use them strategically. So I don't recall any matches other than this year where you haven't used a challenge.
Short-term memory. I mean, I've played
right.
I've played like 35 matches. There's definitely been a lot of matches with no challenges, but it's a different game than it used to be. And I think, you know, if you're the person who's fully in control of it and you're the one who's issuing the challenge, you can kind of you can control, you know, you gut it out, right? You can ride that wave, and it's part of your strategy. But if you're not, and you're in a rhythm and your manager is challenging for you, I feel like that's a whole different challenge in itself. You know, because it can throw your rhythm off. If you're not ready, you know, it's like you're not even thinking about it. You just want to stay locked in. And then there's a pause. You've got to wait. You start to feel that bad blood sometimes from the other side. They think you're being petty. Mm-hmm. That's emotionally a hard thing to deal with. Did that kind of affect you at all with what was going on with those challenges?
Not really. The only one that bugged me was the shield one, because neither of us had it right. I would have, you know, gotten the bonus question, I think, if I had gotten that point. And I had just watched the match where that was a question and all three players put different words. I think Scrimshaw just put the word shields and they took it. And I was just like, oh, that's kind of a bummer. But, you know, with Star Wars, especially people playing these perfect games, like it's going to come down to, okay, what's the exact line?
Yeah, with that being the case with what people are doing now, right? With you obviously you watch the Dimelanta Scrimshaw match, and I think what it makes you realize is, like any of the specialized leagues, and you can't, this is not the case for singles and teams because there's just too many movies, but whether it's Intergeekdom or it's Star Wars or it's one of these exhibition matches, when there's a finite amount of information at a certain point, everybody will crack the code. They'll figure out a way to study it in a way that is so infallibly perfect. There are no questions missed. And so when I watched that Dimelanta Scrimshaw match, I was like, okay, these are two players that have decided they are going to make their whole lives about this. There's nothing, there's no way one of these guys is going to lose this match. And it, I mean, it seemed at one moment like nobody ever was going to lose.
Yeah.
And so my question is, does that affect, as a player who now is getting back in the fold, is your study method and your approach different than it would have been, say, a year ago? Do you look at it differently?
Oh yeah. I'm trying to memorize exact lines. Just I got to get it perfect.
That is so crazy.
You know, on the heels of your answer about Sam and working with him in this situation, now having experienced Sam as a manager in a match, like fully experienced the fact that he will jump and challenge, do you have, in your mind, did you guys have a conversation afterwards about how you might handle the Dimelanta situation? Because as Ben said, and my manager are taking it upon themselves to challenge can throw off the player who would normally shrug off challenging a question like that because they want to save their challenge till the third round. Did you make it clear to him, hey, I will decide when the challenges are, not you?
Yeah, we're going to have a conversation about the challenges because I've got some ideas, but yeah.
I think that's fair. I think that's fair. You want to make sure, you know, jumping at, and Sam sometimes forgets he's not playing anymore. And certainly that came through in this match as I was watching it. And of course, he was trying to fight for his player. So credit to Sam as a manager, but sometimes that can throw you off when you're in the middle of a rhythm and you're already trying to, you know, just try, you know, things have to work a certain way as you're negotiating a match or navigating a match. So like having that throw you off, you can almost feel pushed back by your own manager in that moment. So yeah, it's good to hear you're going to have a conversation with about how to work this going forward for sure.
You know? Yeah. I mean, it definitely worked out for the best for that thousand years question, but at the same time, I felt bad for Adam, because like he clearly knew the answer.
See, Molly's sweet. That's the problem, people. She's not a cutthroat. She's not gonna set people on fire. She's not Dark Ray. She got Dark Ray tendencies, but she's not mean. You know.
Now that I know how the challenges are gonna go, I'm ready.
Okay. Good.
Are do you? I mean, and granted, you can refuse to answer this question if you don't want to share any information. But is your study method for how you're approaching these movies? Are you like a I've heard competitors talk about, like, I spend a week on this movie, then a week on this movie, or I focus on characters, right? You know, like that kind of a thing. Is it very regimented, or is it just like you're obviously in a room that is entirely Star Wars. So your home is kind of probably a pretty good place to start.
Yeah. I mean, our job is to talk about Star Wars. So it's like all the information is there. I just have to be able to pull it. And usually it's just watching the movies. I mean, that's all we really do.
What's the like division as far as extended universe stuff work? Cause I know some stuff in these questions I've noticed is not stuff that if you just watch the movies, you will know the answer to. So it's stuff that you have to have read a book or looked at an action figure or something like that. How do you approach that information? Like what, you know?
Just watching previous matches, getting a feel for, okay, how deep are they going into Star Wars lore that isn't in the movies? Most of it's like species or, you know, who actor who played this. And some of it is like, where was this filmed? And I don't know. A lot of that stuff I just already know from what we do and everything. So, yeah. It's a lot of visual dictionary stuff, too.
Do you have a drawer full of Star Trek stuff, like your chocolate drawer, that you don't tell Alex about?
No, I do not.
Is there another franchise you love as much as Star Wars? Is there another one that you, and can you say that there's another one that may come close, even not necessarily as much, but maybe it comes close?
I don't know about another franchise, but there are definitely other like TV series out there that I love just as much as Star Wars. I've said before, and like if Christian ever wanted to do a Buffy exhibition match for the TV series, I'm all about it.
Got it. I asked because I wonder if seeing Alex going into IG, if that's kind of inspired you a little bit, or as you, because we've seen the stuff on Twitter where you're helping him study as well. Has that kind of has that idea started to happen in your head?
Well, I mean, I kind of started playing in the Star Wars League because I was helping him study, and then I was like, I know all this stuff now, and I'm getting to that point with the IG stuff too.
Wow. Like, okay. I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do think about that sometimes. And I had a conversation with somebody the other day about this, who's in the IG division, about what's the difference between an IG player who's really good at Star Wars and a Star Wars League player, and how far is that gap? And I wonder, what do you think, John? I mean, do you think the IG versus Star Wars player is wide?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, if I wanted to prepare for Star Wars, I could do that in 2 to 3 months, right?
Yeah.
For IG, I think it would take me an entire year because there are so many movies, and people like, I don't know, we like to bash IG a little bit playfully, like, oh, it's 20 to 30 movies. There's actually 200 some movies that you have to kind of, I mean, like The Shadow with Alec Baldwin is a movie you'd have to actually know. And what is the artifact that they are trying to get in The Shadow? you might have to know the name of that as well. So it's not just like, oh, bad movies like Green Lantern. There's always like The Phantom, right? Who remembers Billy Zane and The Phantom with Christy Swanson? Like, you're going to have to know that kind of stuff. So those are the things that deep diving in your mind that you don't think about, or even Road to Perdition, which is considered a comic book movie. Right? Or Ghost World or American Splendor, possibly. So there's all so many of these movies that you'd have to study in depth and learn all the knowledge about that I think it would take you a very long time. Whereas Star Wars, 9 to 10 movies, you can rewatch them in one day. You could watch, what, 6, 7 of the movies if you really were dedicated and just make notes throughout the day. And the next day, start all over again. So if you had that time, especially if you're on COVID relief or whatever, you could get boned up on it if you wanted to. It just would take maybe 2 to 3 months, but I think for Inner Geekdom, it just was taking so much more longer.
Yeah.
Well, I think my question there and sort of what I'm really asking, and Molly, I'd love to know what you think about this, is if you're an IG player who's really good, like let's say you're at the Cushing, Kalinowski, Smets level of IG, and you just walk into a Star Wars match, how do you think you do if you're that level of IG player? I mean, how deep do you think that starts? Because like obviously IG, you have to know Star Wars really well. I mean, how different do you think that knowledge base is?
Yeah.
At this point, you would have to be very dedicated to specific Star Wars knowledge, as well as all the IG stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know when Cushing got the Ninka question, I think that was an overtime question that she got, that I don't know that that's ever said in the movie, or maybe it is, but like it happens really quickly. That was a great, great pull. And it's stuff like that that they'll need to be able to hold their own in Star Wars.
The Star Wars division. Now, we have Ben Goddard here, who's obviously playing in the IG division. He can pull you up here. Ben, I'd love to actually know your opinion on this as well. You know, as a player who studied for IG and who's paid attention to these Star Wars matches, when you watch the Star Wars matches, do you find yourself thinking, yeah, I do pretty well here? Or does it feel like it's still a level above where you've prepared?
Round one, I can do okay in. I don't think I would have gone perfect in either match, but I mean, like in IG, I know like a lot of people that just casually watch MCU movies and stuff like that can get, you know, 7 or 8 points in round one. And same with, you know, movie trivia, like, you know, the regular leagues, everyone's like, oh, those are easy questions. But especially during this tournament, and you've seen, and like Molly and Wit played so well, and, you know, Joseph and Andrew, like you've really seen these Star Wars players just like flourish. And that's why, honestly, Star Wars is my favorite league to watch because of those deep cut questions. Because like I went and like when I met Alex it was after Spectacular, and just like the question of like what Jedi gets killed by Jango Fett on the balcony, that's just like the perfect Star Wars question, because you can watch Attack of the Clones for the rest of your life and they never say his name. The guy doesn't say, hello, I am so and so, and then Jango Fett kills him. Like, he just dies. So like Molly said, like that's strictly a visual dictionary book thing, and that's what really separates. Because I feel like if you watch all the MCU movies over and over and over again and put the subtitles on and catch like, okay, this is Iridium, this is the Tesseract, this is this, they're in Lagos, they're right here, he's driving an Audi, you can pick all these things up. You can't do that in Star Wars League. You can put all the subtitles you want on, you can pause the movie and say, oh, you know, Anakin's cruiser's yellow right here, but you have to go to the visual dictionary. And I think you're underestimating 3 months of Star Wars studying that you could hang in this tournament, John. I think because of your former Star Wars knowledge, you would know. But if you just started studying, I think it would be different. You know how to study movie trivia, so that's different.
Well, see, the thing is, the way I look at it is I'm studying to win a title, right? So that's why I say IG would take a year. You could be competitive in IG probably in 4 to 5 months. But to win a title, I think you'd have to really go in depth in these movies and have the time. Let's put that out there. A lot of us have full-time jobs or trying to have full-time jobs. So putting that time in to study all those movies, not a lot of people have that. So it takes longer. I think with Star Wars, you could be competitive in 3 to 4 months, and we'll find out someday. 3 to 4 months to try to go for a title if you wanted to. Well, I think you could.
Star Wars has always been this league, and that's, I feel like that's the difference. Like, Inner Geekdom used to be like, hey, do you like comic book movies? You know, are you like Hector Navarro and Adam?
Right.
Like, where he just knows, like, even before he watched any MCU movies, Hector just had that knowledge. And same with, you know, Robert Meyer Burnett. But then, you know, you have Rachel and Mike Kalinowski, and now Kevin Smets and Shandru. And even so, and like you said, like Alex has been the most dominant Star Wars player and possibly the most dominant champion the Schmodown has ever seen in Star Wars. He's struggled a little bit in Inner Geekdom. So like, it's just like that difference in knowledge. And it's really interesting to watch. Like, that's why I'm excited to watch Alex play, because he's been so good for so long in one league. And, you know, we saw him in the exhibition Lord of the Rings match. So that's another franchise that he can, if he spends two franchises, you know, he's getting 10 points. Yeah. And so it's going to be interesting to see. Molly, my only question I had for you was, what did you think of, you know, you had so many challenges in your match of like the specificity of like this and that. What did you think of the Demolanta and Scrimshaw challenge, Luke's to Luke's hatred? Like, how did you feel about that?
I think that was completely warranted. I think that was a good challenge. I also think Scrimshaw like understood and probably knew that that was the answer, but didn't like, I don't know, maybe he just didn't think to write hatred down as part of the answer, but I think they both understood what the answer was. But I think that was a warranted challenge.
I think it's also Scrimshaw. Yeah, go ahead, Ben. Sorry,
I felt like Scrimshaw not writing hatred was him getting tired. That was I felt like I could see it just that like extra layer. His muscles, his mental muscles, were just getting a little tired, because I know Scrimshaw's watched that scene a million times. Mm-hmm. He visualizes the scene. He thinks about how that interaction goes, and he's not locked in at that moment like Demolanta still is, where Demolanta's, you can see Demolanta, he's in the same position every time he gets the questions. He's like, he's sitting there, he's closing his eyes for a second, even if he's not actually moving them, and he's literally just playing the scene in the movie, and then he just goes and writes it. And that's what he was doing for every question, and that's exactly what he did there. And I feel like Scrimshaw was 10% behind on that question, and that's why that happened.
Yeah, and we'll find out later on in the show what his thought process was with that. But it felt to me, and I hear your point, it felt to me like, because Molly had mentioned earlier, he got away with shields on another question earlier. Maybe in his mind, he's like, well, Luke will do here. It's Luke, and thought that it would just be the spirit of the answer would be enough to get him the point in this situation. And maybe he hadn't watched what the Star Wars division has become recently, because I mean, Joseph's been very busy with a lot of things he's doing outside of the Schmodown, and maybe didn't understand the specificity of this situation and how the tournament has changed and how the Star Wars matches are now played and approached by a lot of the players with specificity. So maybe in that moment he thought, I'll get it with Luke. Maybe he was tired. I mean, that's a hell of a match to ask two people to go through. So
I think it's a little bit of both, just because like Molly even said, and I listened to the rundown, and the rundown boys were even saying like three different answers got accepted for energy shield or, you know, whatever the correct answer was. I can't remember. So, and Joseph has been an OG Star Wars competitor. So he's seen the flexibility in the answers of like, we know, you know, so we're going to give you this. And it's not like that anymore. It's it's Luke's hatred. And it's one of those questions almost that it's kind of a movie quote question, but it's not labeled as a movie quote question. So like, you can debate about the semantics of that, but I do feel like they got that one right. And here's a super chat.
Yeah. The root of the question idea doesn't apply here as it now has been argued. It does in regular league. So how much do you want to bet that Alex gets a damn it Scrimshaw shirt?
We've been talking about that for a long time. That needs to happen.
Well, Molly, you've got a little bit of time here before, as you're leading up to your match against our guy, Andrew Demolanta, who appears to be as focused as any player we've seen. Are you feeling ready? Are you feeling excited for the match? Are you feeling intimidated by the match? Honestly,
not intimidated. I mean, I live with Alex. I'm used to
that, being intimidated.
Like,
no,
that what? Like laser focus. I'm excited. I'm definitely gonna step it up. I'm ready.
Well, I've got that unbelievable match.
I've got that win under my belt, so now I'm like, okay, now I really want this.
I mean,
that's how it starts.
It's true. Yeah. I think when you get that win, I think that first win, it feels so different than that first loss. So, I'm excited to see I'm excited to see what you bring to the table. I have enjoyed watching these Star Wars matches, to be honest with you, far more than I expected. It's the league. It tends to be the league that when I watch, I feel like I'm watching another language half the time. So I zone out, but it's been so exciting to watch.
It's so fun. Like, I feel like I know the five pointers more than like the first round questions. Like, that's where my brain is.
You talk about a victory. Andrew just finally got his first victory too. So this could, exactly. I mean, both Molly and Andrew getting their taste of this first victory in the Star Wars division could lead to another titanic battle between them coming up soon. So yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
So I think we're going to bring on Alex here in just a second. Obviously as soon as we have him, but I'd love to hear what he has to say about his upcoming matches and obviously what he thinks about this IG division, but also what he's thinking as he's watching the Star Wars division. Yeah. I wonder if Alex feels more intimidated than Molly. Do you know what I mean? Because heavy is the head. You know, Molly is playing with house money a little bit, right? She came in, she got signed, she got her win. Now she's 1-0. It's exciting. You know, Alex has been the most, I think he has been the most dominant champion we've seen in Chmodown. I think the only, you could say the most dominant champions were the Patriots because of the sheer number of defenses.
Yeah.
But I also feel that in a league that is increasingly gotten more and more and more competitive, it feels to me like Alex, people know exactly what they have to do to beat him and they haven't been able to do it. You know what I'm saying?
It's weird. I don't know. It's weird because I look at it and I don't know if in my mind anybody is necessarily the most dominant champion, because like you said, the Patriots, but that was early on in the league as well.
Yeah.
You look at the Shire Wolves. The Shire Wolves played some of the best teams one-on-one. You know, Ben, you took a loss from them, a tough loss from them. They've gutted out so many wins. And their loss to Corruption was a legitimately, you know, like, it's a damn good loss if you're going to have a loss in your retirement match. So I think you could look at them as possibly some of the most dominant. I mean, playing us three times and beating us three times, I don't know if that makes them as dominant as you would think in terms of the Patriots. But going 9-0, you can make the case. I think with Scrimshaw is an interesting situation because we haven't seen anybody, maybe besides... with Damon, I haven't seen anybody besides Scrimshaw who and Laura Kelly gave him a game as well, but we haven't seen that. We look and we go, oh man, that person could really go after Damon.
I think I need to see that before I
agree that someone is dominant. I need to see them push to their absolute limit by someone who legitimately comes in with all this fanfare that could beat them. And until that happens, I don't know if I can 100% call Alex the most dominant, but he certainly is dominant in the Star Wars division. Absolutely.
Well, he's definitely a player that there's a lot of buzz about this season. Obviously, you know, coming in and getting his win in Atlanta against our faction mate, Emily Rose.
Got
his first taste of victory there. He hasn't been able to defend his title yet in Star Wars, but he's a very important player to the Rockstars and somebody that I'm excited to talk to. Let's bring him on right now. Yeah. We've got Alex the Demon Damon. Coming on Chmodown backstage for the very first time.
Yeah.
Hello.
What's up, man?
What's up, guys? Good. You know, everything's crazy, but I'm good.
Did you wipe down the headphones? It's the social distancing.
I don't know where she's been.
So let's just start with the obvious one. You watched the matches last week and you watched Perfect versus Perfect. The first time ever in a match where it was decided by a less correct answer, not even a wrong answer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How did watching that match make you feel as the guy that's got that belt?
Excited. Yeah, it's just fun. I mean, I remember at Chicago last year, at Celebration, when me and Scrimshaw had a perfect round one and we both got the bonus question, like, we just looked at each other and we're like, it's fun. Like, I want to keep the belt, obviously, but I love just spouting off weird Star Wars answers with people.
Yeah. Do you ever catch yourself impressed by the questions? Do you ever catch yourself going, oh, I wouldn't have thought to ask. That's a good one. That's a good one.
Yes. And sometimes we come up with weird ones while we're studying where I'm like, oh, that sounds like a Chmodown question. There are sometimes just things in the Chmodown that I don't think to study normally. Like when I study for Dragon Con, I kind of know what kind of Star Wars specific questions I'm going to get.
Good point.
And it's very different from like a movie trivia contest. So I have had to adjust over the last couple of years. But I feel like I'm pretty good at guessing what they're what kinds of questions they're going to ask now.
Well, I think, Alex, on that note, you were telling me about this last year, or it was earlier this year. It was in January in Atlanta. The three of us.
Feels like a year ago, yeah.
It feels like so long ago. We went out and got burgers out in Atlanta, and you were telling me about Dragon Con a little bit and how it's like the craziest level of Star Wars trivia, but it's a different kind of trivia. Why have we not seen any of those players, you think, get involved? Any of those guys? Because you said that's like the toughest competition, right? The Dragon Con players?
Yeah, I know that. There are at least two that I think would throw their hat in the ring. I'd like to see three, but one of them is, I think, 13 years old now. I don't know what the rules are. He's a beast. He's awesome. I can't wait for him to beat me at Dragon Con because everyone cheers for him, obviously.
Yeah. I would love that.
Wow. So, yeah. But so as you're watching the Star Wars matches, you're obviously getting ready, but a lot of your focus, I know, is going towards another division. You have a match coming up this week against Jen Kemp. And that's going to be your second Intergeekdom match. There's a lot of pressure put on you by the rock stars right now to come through and deliver because of the way, unfortunately, that their Roxy's first couple picks didn't perform. And I hate to even say that because Snyder had perfect rounds in both of those matches. I mean, he did perform. He just got outperformed, unfortunately. And they don't, you guys are falling behind a little bit. So are you putting an extra level of pressure on yourself in this Intergeekdom division? Are you studying it the same way you've studied Star Wars?
I would say that I've used a lot of the lessons I've learned from studying Star Wars and put them towards IG. I wouldn't say I'm going as insanely in depth where I don't want to get too deep into it because Roxy will yell at me. But it's similar, but not quite as like, oh, I better write down every number that is spouted out in every scene.
Right. Do you find the natural proclivity? Like, are you and Molly studying both the IG, it's all this IG stuff? Are you guys finding a rhythm in your studying and like, she's coming up with questions, you're coming up with questions that like surprise both of you that, oh yeah, that could be in this one. That's a great thing. Are you guys slowly figuring this out? Like you said, Dragon Con is a certain type of questions, Schmodown different type of questions. I think Ben and I can speak to that, certainly for singles and tags. Like, we know when we study a movie what we for the most part think is going to be a Schmodown question versus something they wouldn't ask. Are you now, as a new competitor in the IG and having seen some of these matches and competed or going to compete here, because you already obviously beat Emily, do you understand now what kind of questions they're looking for, or are you still kind of navigating that when you study?
Yeah, I think I do. And Molly is probably better at picking them out. I mean, when it comes to Star Wars, really, in her promo last week, she said, like, if you ever see Alex look off screen, off stage or something, like that genuinely happened. The Darth Maul, how many horns does he have question? Yeah. She's been asking me for that for like 2 years. And I've always been like, there's no way. They're never going to ask that. And then it happened. And I was like, all right, well, what do I know? So absolutely.
Interesting. So you talk about sort of the different levels of studying. You are watching movies. You are probably watching some movies that are not the best movies. any movies that you've watched so far in the IG that are just like, wow, that is unwatchably awful.
Probably Daredevil. That's one I'm not looking forward to watching again. Green Lantern. Like, a lot of them I've heard are really, really bad. And then I watch them, I'm like, okay, it's not like as bad as I thought it would be. I think Daredevil had lived up to the pain.
I hear RIPD is a one that a lot of people point to as being horrendous. Ghost Rider. Ghost Rider's got Nick Cage, so at least it's fine.
You can muddle through with that. Yeah.
It's one of those things where like you watch these movies and you're like, they better ask a question about this, and then they don't. what was the point?
Have you reappreciated the Hobbit series now, or do you still think it's not as good as Lord of the Rings?
The Hobbit is so frustrating to me because I love the first half of An Unexpected Journey.
Yeah,
I think they nailed it. Once they leave the Shire, it feels like they can't decide if it should be like a kid's book, which is what The Hobbit was.
Yeah,
but they're trying to mix in like elements of Lord of the Rings and make it this big, sprawling, epic journey when it was one book. And then the last movie is like one short chapter of that book.
Yeah.
And I do not like the Battle of Five Armies until they get back to the Shire. The last bit of the Shire I do enjoy, but most of it's just a mess.
See, well, I mean, it's no accounting for taste. He's obviously wrong. But all right, I respect that from Alex. I respect that. That's all right.
Wait, dude, Droka, do you love the Hobbit movies?
I love the Hobbit movies, yeah. I enjoy them because it's actual men doing things as opposed to little kids like those hobbits are. So I like the dwarves are men handling business. The Lord of the Rings movies, I'm just seeing a bunch of kids crying about taking a ring to a mountain. It drives me insane. But everything with Aragorn.
So John learned nothing from Lord of the Rings. John, like,
John was going to keep going.
Until Ben chimed in.
I was going to keep going. I couldn't. I was just like, I was backstage wringing my hand.
I'm like, what extra comment can I get to get Ben to come in here? No, I don't mean to debate. I know people love those movies. And there are some sweet moments, certainly between Samwise and Frodo. But for me overall, I just enjoy the rollicking nature of The Hobbit and what they're going through. And I think Martin Freeman is a fantastic actor. And I think, what's his name who plays the main dwarf? I forget his name.
Richard Armitage.
Richard Armitage. He is so good in that role, which you've never seen him play a role like that since or before. And so I thought it was a nice showcase for him as well. But there's a lot of great things in Lord of the Rings. Absolutely. I just ball bust Ben as much as I can when I can. So anyway, yeah.
I want to remind everybody here, by the way, who's watching this right now, that if you guys are not already subscribed to the channel, please hit subscribe. But also, this is available as an audio show. Every single week, this goes up as a podcast. So go check it out if you want to listen to this instead of, you know, watch for 2 hours. We don't chat it out probably as much as we maybe should or could, because I think we get so wrapped up in the conversations. But I do want to remind everybody here, it's available all the places you can get it, you know, on Apple Podcasts, anywhere that podcasts are available. So go check that out. But so I think probably the easy answer for you, Alex, is that you'd love to see Molly in the finals. I'm guessing. I think unless there's someone to put you on the spot here and you're going to say someone else. If it wasn't Molly, if it wasn't going to be Molly, let's just say she's not in the picture. Who of the other players that are still in the tournament are you thinking you'd like to get a shot at in that final?
Okay, so who to play me? If it's not Molly, there's no one in the tournament that I wouldn't enjoy playing. I love Ken. Laura obviously was fantastic. It's spectacular. And DiMolanta is making a serious, serious run. Like, there's no one in that show in the tournament that I wouldn't want to face. I get DiMolanta's someone I've never faced before, and I know how hungry he is for it. So I'll go with him.
How would you have done, honestly, in the matches you watched? If you don't have to answer if you don't want. But would you have been perfect in the perfect match?
I would have had to go to multiple choice on one.
Wow.
So there is that. Wow. I'll be honest.
Okay.
Wow, look at that.
But I'm not the one. I haven't been studying Star Wars. I've been helping Molly study Star Wars.
Right. But still, by the same token, you know, what gets asked in one match may not get asked in yours. Right. So
that's the thing. Like, I was almost kind of heartbroken for Scrimshaw, because at this point, I feel like he should have beaten me at least once. And every match that I've had with him, I feel like he just got a rough draw. Mm-hmm. And that would have been my rough draw question in that match.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, we're going to be bringing on Scrimshaw a little later to talk about that match. I mean, talk about a brutal way to lose. You're not supposed to go perfect and lose. That's not supposed to happen. Tim Sim here with the super chat. This is your reminder that Lord of the Rings is the greatest of all time trilogy, and it's way over The Hobbit.
It's not the greatest of all time.
I don't think anybody's arguing that the Lord of the Rings trilogy is not as good as The Hobbit. I mean, I don't even think John.
Yeah, no, I'm not arguing that at all. It's personal preference, you know, for me. I don't connect to Frodo and Sam the way that other people do. They get on my nerves. But Aragorn is incredible, even though he's playing two women. And of course, Legolas is fantastic. Gimli's my guy. Gimli is my spirit animal in Lord of the Rings. That's basically me in the smaller version, which is why I like the dwarves and the hobbits. So yeah, no one's arguing that. And it's not the greatest
character
trilogy.
In the trilogy is Boromir, and everybody knows it. It's really
I love Boromir.
It's Boromir's story. Justice for Boromir, I always say. No, he's my
is that an arrow in my chest? Oh.
I think that the Boromir scene when he's dying at the end of the first movie, and I would have followed you, my brother, my captain, my king, is my single favorite moment in all of Lord of the Rings.
Exactly.
That's me the hardest.
Exactly.
But anyway.
So many people angry in the chat. It's funny. So many people, totally ignoring the lessons of Lord of the Rings. Look at these people with their terrible comments in the chats, you know.
PLD here with the super chat. Tim is wrong. There's only one return, and it's of the Jedi.
Oh, PLD, another one. Nice.
Clerks 2, right?
Say that again.
That's from Clerks 2.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah.
All right, Alex. So we're talking about the Intergeekdom tournament a little bit here. Obviously, you've got some pretty heavy hitters in the tournament. You walk into this thing knowing that you're already a champion. So there's a little bit of house money here you're playing with. You want to do as well as you can, but obviously you're going up against legends. Who is the player that you are the most interested in getting to the top of the mountain and taking down? I mean, obviously, currently you've got Smets at champion, but I think there's an argument to be made that by the time you get there, it could be Kalinowski. It could be Parker. Some people think that's going to happen.
If you get there.
Right.
Yeah. Don't forget the guy who's playing him for the belt, Sean Drew. again, just come on, y'all.
Well, I think it's kind of just whoever I'm about to face. Like Hannah's coming up for me, and everyone definitely feels like it's just another step up. Kalinowski is someone that, I mean, I was a fan of before I stepped into the Schmodown, so facing him would be a lot of fun for me. I'd like to get another crack at Parker just because we had that Lord of the Rings exhibition match that was so much fun. Yeah. It would be fun to see how we do if neither of us get Middle Earth.
Yeah.
You look at the situation, you look at these IG players and what is your mental approach here? What are you factoring? What do you do? Are you studying, like we said already, how you're studying, but are you looking at how these players play, and are you preparing down the road for, as Ben was saying, maybe whoever's at the top of the mountain, but you've still got to go through this tournament. So are you watching all these other matches pretty in depth? Are you just kind of just focusing on you and your gameplay and just making sure you're prepared on game day to take care of business as best as you can? Or are you already kind of peeking forward or peeking ahead to see who might be waiting for you down the road and watching their matches to kind of figure out how to play them mentally?
Yeah, I'd say I'm going like just one match at a time. And okay. Even with Star Wars, I always consider this just a challenge for me. I want to see how good I can do. And hopefully that means I also beat the opponent. But I'm mostly just studying the same way I study for Star Wars. And then when I get to someone I'm going to face, I will watch their matches, because now I have to worry about the wheel. Like Star Wars League, as I spin it and I'm like, okay, no real decisions to be made.
Right.
Now it's like, okay, I should probably know what they are good at, what they are bad at, find out what I'm bad at and fill those gaps in. There's a little bit of that, but I'm not going and watching all of Robert Parker's matches right now or Sean Drew's, because they're still a ways off.
Yeah, also,
first.
Right. And there's spinner's choice and opponent's choice in IG versus Star Wars, where there isn't that, at least in the tournament. So that's something to factor in as well. Like, what if you get opponent's choice? What is that person going to give to you? Right. There's all kinds of categories that people don't know. And that might be an advantage you have, Alex, is that people don't know what you don't know. And so you're still, as a new player, they may take a chance on a category that you've secretly been studying, having not said a word about in any interview, and that you'll knock it out of the park. Or they could give you a category that you didn't study as strongly and could really catch you on that. That must concern you.
He's obviously paying attention to the question on screen. I can see his eyes dart. We have
There it is. He was like, "What was Roka saying? I don't care. It's Star Wars." What?
Just for fun, can this one stump the Daemon? Who is Jabba's head of security in Return of the Jedi? Hint: it's not Bib Fortuna. I think I might know this one. Maybe.
Wow.
That's probably wrong though. But
head of security. Like, I'm probably immediately overthinking this. And the name that jumped into my head was Bidlo Quirv, but he's dead by the time of Return of the Jedi. So like the head of security is not, unless he means the droid, like the doorbell droid. I always call it like the Nest of Star Wars, which is like TT-8L/Y.
You nerd.
I'm not sure what head of security is, though, so I might be wrong. I might be just throwing out weird ass names.
Looks like PLD guessed Effant Mon. He says PLD correct. Maybe that's what he's talking about.
That's definitely not
what I was going to say.
I did not know he had a position in Jabba's Palace. Well, wow. You just made me stronger.
Way to go, Dagan.
100%. I would never, ever have said that one. Then we have Let's Get Ready to Talk Schmodown podcast. Alex is your biggest fan, Ferris. I picked you winning the whole IG tournament in our bracket. I want to see you take everyone's soul.
That's intense.
I do want to ask, you know, so obviously your match against Jen Kemp comes up this week, but we have seen the other side of the bracket, who the winner of your match is going to play. We have seen that Brandon Hanna took down Saul. Have you been watching all the IG matches?
Yeah.
I mean, as they come out, right? Because that's like the most fun thing, right? As you're preparing, you watch them. How have you been doing? I mean, how would you have done in that match?
On it, it's like a lot more all over the place because you know sometimes someone will spin a strength of mine, sometimes they will spin a weakness, and I more try to focus on, oh, they just spun something that I might not be as good at, and I want to really test my mettle there. So I think I've been doing pretty well. I kind of feel like this is it's a lot different for me, where I feel like I'm just hanging on enough, and every gap that I get in between a match, I have a chance to get stronger and fill in more gaps. So just we'll see if my studying can keep up with the matches.
I've been pretty impressed actually so far with how enjoyable the matches have been via StreamYard, you know, Zoom. I think there's an element I think that we miss a little bit of just the, you know, obviously the live events, that's very different, but even just the studio matches, it doesn't feel as drastically different, I think, as I was expecting, you know? I mean, how have you guys felt watching as fans?
I've been having a lot of fun. I mean, I would much, much rather have it be like this than not at all.
No, I've been loving the Star Wars matches. I mean, one of the elements that that totally unexpected for me was Smets and I have played each other in just about every Star Wars match. So it's been fun having my ass handed to me by Kevin Smets, but it's brought an extra element of joy to playing the match because you appreciate the, I don't know, the level of these questions and the obscurity of some of the answers. You just really just appreciate it madly and playing. And Kevin, let me tell you something, and let me reveal something right now. Kevin has maybe been wrong twice in the three matches we've played together. And he's answering before other people answer on text. And it is,
you're talking about in Star Wars, you guys are playing against each other. You're playing along with the matches.
Yes. On text. We play each other on text. Right. And where I'm getting like three or four, right, in the first round, he's getting them all right. And then rolling through the second round. And he would have gotten a multiple choice, I think, on one of them in the DiMolanta Scrimshaw match as well. So it's been a joy, Kevin's desire to play Star Wars and be a part of the Star Wars
thing. So he's been texting me as well.
that brings up an interesting point. I think it's a worthwhile one to ask here. So I asked this to Molly, and Alex, you're obviously you're the guy who's now going the other way doing this. The difference between the Star Wars knowledge you need to have as an IG player and the Star Wars knowledge you need to have to be a Star Wars player. I mean, how wide do you think that is? Because what it sounds like you're saying, Roka, is that Smets is the guy who maybe is ready to make that jump.
Listen,
you know, I mean,
Ben, you don't walk into another man's yard or another person's yard and think you can take what they have. And that's what Alex is doing without a response. And that's what Alex is doing by walking into IG thinking he takes Smets' title. And Smets is like, okay. And he's preparing to walk himself into Star Wars and take a Damon's title. So I respect that. Smets is an ultra competitor, and he respects the game, respects the opponents, but he wants those belts. So as someone who once said all the belts, all the records, I absolutely support everything Smets is doing and his desire to be part of it. So, yeah.
I mean, yeah, I'm over here in IG to just have fun. You know, Star Wars is my everyday life. And I'm like, now I have a reason to watch more movies and remember that other fandoms exist. Like, I'm just here for fun. But if Smets wants to come and play in my yard, that's okay.
He can do that. I like this Dagan suggestion.
We're welcoming. Yeah, yeah.
I like this Dagan suggestion. Title versus title. For both titles, Damon versus Smets for both the IG and the Star Wars title. Man, I don't think we've ever had that. That would be incredible.
It'd be hilarious if we somehow swapped belts by the end of it.
We've got a super chat here from EY Geekness here. Alex has a major advantage in IG. When the opponent spins the wheel, they may stick with a category they may not like as much because they do not want to take a chance that Star Wars or Lord of the Rings comes up. Mm. You know, I think one thing that I find so interesting about IG, and obviously, you know, Alex, we got to let you go here in just a second because we do have our next competitor, the Hitman, coming on in just a minute. Ew. But one thing I have thought about, and Roka, I know you agree with me on this, is the idea that in IG players have strengths and weaknesses. That's going to be a bygone era pretty soon. That's not how it should be in IG. Yeah. And it's really, if you think about it from the perspective of the way that players are approaching it now, if Smets redefined the paradigm of what a player does and how they study, that's just going to be the standard. We've all seen it. You adapt or die. Yeah. I mean, you talk about, John, with me, how in regular singles and teams play, all these ideas that I was throwing out last season that everybody was saying, oh, these are so cool and different. Like, that's just the way people look at it now. Nobody's going to give me any credit in season 8. That's just going to be the way people play the game. Oh, yeah. You don't have to watch movies to get good at Shmodown, period.
Yeah.
And you don't have to, you should not be walking in inner geeking thinking, oh, I have a weakness on the wheel. You'll just lose. There's no way that works. Right.
You're absolutely right, man. You're absolutely right. It's right. This is the change, right? And some of the OG competitors are going to be able to hang with the change, and some of them aren't. I mean, Dan Murrow coming back and losing to Andrew Guy, that was the wake-up call for Dan. Dan was like, okay, this is a different league now. And if I want to be a part of it, if I want to succeed in it, I'm going to have to study at the levels that I'm seeing other people study, right? Ben, you did the same thing. Ben, you like a lot of people to give you credit now, you beautiful-minded, but you're right. By season 8, season 9, everyone is going to be so part of this thing that you're going to have recency bias when people start to claim, like they did on Twitter, that somehow Kevin Smets invented studying for a Shmodown match, which was one of the most ridiculous things I ever read on Twitter. And this was from another competitor, Sean Sullivan, who was involved in that thread, echoing that thought, which drove me insane. Everyone knows that when this whole thing started, people were just going on what knowledge they had. I was the one that started studying, then Kalinowski, then Rachel Cushing. That was really got it. And then, you know, and then you and Kevin around the same time kind of showing how it's done. So you saw people studying in ways than before. But of course, recency bias is like all of a sudden, because Kevin is destroying people right now, they think, oh, Kevin's style, or Kevin was the one who, you know, kind of that what Kevin did was take what everyone else had done and bring it in and improve upon it in a new league, which is the IG league. And we've seen that happen. I think with Star Wars, DeMilanta's doing that. Lord God Almighty, the way he's studying, I don't know if I only know a few Star Wars competitors, but I've never seen anyone study the way DeMilanta is studying, and it's coming from what everyone else is doing. So I think in every league, you're right, Ben, by season 8, season 9, this is going to be the standard thing, and people coming into the league are going to have to do that before they even walk through the door. You don't even get the chance as soon as you start to be behind, because if you do, you're not going to get matches. It's like I liken it to pickup basketball. If you don't win in that first time out, you're not going to see the court again for 2 hours. And that's just how it works now.
Yeah. So Alex, we're excited to see what you do against Jen Kemp. I wish you the best of luck, my friend. I'm excited to see who comes out on the other end of the Star Wars tournament. See, you know, who's going to take you on, my friend. If you want to find Alex, you're at Star Wars Explained everywhere. Yeah.
Yep.
Tua.
Excellent. Well, coming up in just a couple minutes, we've got Brandon, the Hitman, Hannah, Alex. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Alex.
Thanks, guys.
Very soon. See you, my friend. So coming up in a couple minutes here, we've got Brandon, the Hitman, Hannah. John, I'm going to actually have to jump out of the show for a few minutes and
wait, leave you what? With you can leave me with Hannah? and at least bring back Goddard in here.
Yeah, I got it.
but you know, obviously, you know, Hannah showed something against Saul this week, which I, you know, I'm disappointed I'm not going to get to talk about it for too much, but hopefully I'm back in just a couple minutes. And guys, while we have Brandon, be sure to get all of your super chats and Streamlabs in. We'll have him for about 20. And then we have Scrimshaw coming on at 2 o'clock. So it's still a great second half of the show. Be sure to hit that subscribe button. Go to patreon.com/theshmodown if you want early access to all of the matches. I believe Alex Damon against Jen Kemp is actually up now. Is that right?
It is.
Cool.
Yeah, so you guys can go watch that.
Yesterday was 10 and today is 5, I believe. $5 patrons get that match today.
Right on.
Yeah.
Do we have any Streamlabs?
Like button.
Yeah, make sure you guys are hitting the like button as well. And then I got two Streamlabs right here. Rhett's
Ben, do you need to jump off or can you answer these?
I do, yeah. I'm going to jump off here. I'll come back and see you guys in a few minutes.
All right. Okay, sounds good.
I've never been a Star Wars guy, neither the movie or Shmodown matches, but I must say that this tournament has even excited a Star Wars cynic like me. I so love the Shmodown and everyone in it. I'm telling you, man, like you can't not watch these and not be excited for the league. Just like the level of competition, regardless of, you know, whatever movie you do or do not like, you got to love it. And then
if you want to be a part of this thing, this is the level one, like I was saying here earlier. And the thing is, what's interesting too, is that you're seeing people watch these Star Wars matches who maybe in the past had kind of, you know, gone back to watch them, but they're watching them live. They want to be part of the conversation with other fans who are talking about the results of these matches. They want to experience it themselves and share in the fandom. You know, it's like, it's almost like Christian has been saying, it feels like a sporting event to watch these Star Wars matches. You've got to watch it, and you can put the 24-hour window all you want, but you do it at your own peril because people want to talk about these matches. That Scrimshaw Dimelante match, that's as close to a sports match as I've ever seen in the Schmodown. And all I wanted to do was talk about it with a bunch of people. And that's what Christian wants, that sports feeling. You know,
and that exactly like the Dimelante Scrimshaw match, when you see these guys just going punch for punch for 45 minutes for three rounds. Yeah. Like I would have loved like to see just who edged him out in the speed round. If the betting round would have made a difference or something like that. But it was so great. And then Keith Kilduff. Hi, all. Great show thus far. I asked the Rundown boys this before. But if Alex defends the belt more times than the Patriots, does he then rightly take place on Rushmore? And if not, what does he need to do to get on it?
Well, the Patriots are only on the tag team Rushmore. They're not on the main Rushmore.
No, yeah.
But I don't know. It's a good question. I think you have to. It's like Ali, right? Muhammad Ali was undefeated, for those you remember, or maybe in Tyson. It isn't until somebody knocks you down or fights you tooth and nail all the way to the end, and people universally believe they've watched one of the most amazing matches ever, that I think you get vaulted into that legendary status. Yes, he is a legend in the Schmodown. In the Star Wars division. But to be a legend in the Schmodown, I think Alex has to be challenged. And we haven't really seen. And yes, Laura Kelly pushed him. Scrimshaw pushed him. But Alex has such an ease to it. You want to see Alex somehow get shaken, somehow get nervous, somehow this other side of Alex comes out and you see him fight tooth and nail for that victory and you feel it in your bones organically as a fan. I think that's what's going to vault Alex into legend status, full-on legend status.
I think seeing this turn, because like Star Wars has always been the most niche division. Like, you know, we've had bigs like, you know, Ken and Sam Witwer now Alex being, you know, a champion for almost 2 years now. And so I think after everyone, like almost 2,000 people per match watching these people just go boom, boom, like knocking these out of the park, seeing Alex go up against this person now, this will be his challenge. Now everyone knows how hungry Laura Kelly, Andrew Dimelante, Molly, and then we got Ken and Ace this Wednesday. Once we get these final four, whoever Alex faces out of these four, he will have solidified himself. And I think that what he's got to do, he's got to at least go to a number one contender or a belt match in Intergeekdom. Right. If he does either of those, he's on Rushmore or at least in top five for me for sure.
Yeah. And we've got to see all these, we see all these incredible Star Wars players coming in now. Now, if he goes through these players and retains that belt, now this is next level status. And all of us are excited about it.
Especially like going through a tournament. Cause you know, Andrew Dimelante was 0-1 and Laura Kelly, I can't remember if it was her first match or not. And that was for a title shot. And then now like they're going through a tournament, like they have this road, but we got him waiting in the wings. Okay. The man with the giant flamethrower over social media this last week, he tried to redeem himself by doing a charity stream and he raised, you know, $4,000 and it was a great thing, but we all know he's truly the biggest heel of all time. And that's Brandon, the Hitman Hanna, coming off his big victory over, unfortunately, my teammate, Saul. You know, you hate to see it, but, Brandon, how you doing?
I'm doing all right. You know, I mean, I didn't hate to see it. I loved seeing it.
Yeah, I hope so.
I sure hope so. Yeah, you won. And look, dude, let's break it down here. you really put your, for lack of a better term, you put your private parts on the line here with this this promo you launched, and of course was the talk of the Schmodown. And, you know, and I took it down a little bit, but like people loved it. People were now wanting to see what you could do in your match, and that's what you do when you've lost a couple of really hard losses or taken a couple of hard losses. You kind of have to reinvent yourself, and it seems like from the promo and from the cool, calm, and collected way you played in this match, you've kind of reinvented yourself. Characters aside, it seems like you've reinvented yourself as a player. Maybe these losses have turned you around in your approach to the game.
Yeah, losing, of course, is never fun, especially when you lose to somebody like Chandru Dhandapani. It stings a little bit. And so, yeah, I did have to kind of reinvent myself and find how do I get back to winning again. And it's not about putting on a show. It's not about being a character. It's about just coming in here and finally getting it done. And that is exactly what I did against Saul.
Now, yeah, Brandon, for lack, like the Rundown Boys talked about it a little bit, your career was kind of on the line for this match. Like you would have lost 3 in a row.
Yeah.
To a rookie in IG, you know, after the promo you put out, like you torched the entire league, you burned every bridge. Did that put more pressure on yourself? Like you saw the reaction online, you saw you and Saul were going back and forth online about it. Mm-hmm. You literally just went after every single person you could. If you saw him, you made a promo about him.
Yeah.
So did that put more pressure on you with this match that literally if you lose first round to an IG rookie that's never played, never appeared, like no one's ever seen Saul, well, let alone even, like.
And even add to that, Ben, a person you were traded for to create space for that person to compete. There was even more pressure on here.
Yeah, I didn't allow myself to feel that pressure. I used it as motivation. Obviously, what happened between me, Kate, and the Den was very unfortunate. I showed how upset I was by that and betrayed that I felt. And I used that as a motivating factor. I never allowed myself to feel the pressure. I decided I'm going to do this thing. I'm going to jump in both feet at a time, and I'm not going to look back.
What surprised you about playing Saul, man? Like he played a lot of people are talking about Saul after this match and the way he hung in there with you all the way to the end for his first match. So were you surprised that you didn't put him away earlier, or did you expect a tough match and got one?
I wasn't surprised. You know, as much as my goal was to go in there and make a fool out of Saul, I knew not to underestimate him. I've spoken to him in the past when we were faction mates. I knew that he knew his stuff and I wasn't going to take that lightly at all. I think he'll be back and I'll be ready for him when he comes back for sure. But he actually, and I'll give him credit as much as I don't want to give anybody credit for anything. I'll give him credit that he performed better in his loss than a lot of people have performed in wins in the first round of this tournament.
Sure.
So
yeah. Cause if he nails his 5-pointer, it's 26-24 at that point. And what, you've got to nail your 5-pointer to win this thing, right? Or your 3-pointer. What did you have left?
I would have had to hit my 5-pointer and win.
That could have put the pressure on you hard. Yeah.
It could have been, but once again, I see that as an opportunity. Cause if I hit that 5-pointer and win, that's 29 points. That breaks Kevin Smets' Innergeekdom 3-round point record.
Great
point. Something that I would have loved to do, given my recent history with Kevin Smets, but I would have seen it as an opportunity, but I didn't have to get that far, and I was happy to take the win.
So, Brandon, next up, you're playing the winner of Jin Kemp and Alex Damon. Everyone knows Alex. We just talked to him. You've seen him in the Lord of the Rings exhibition. His Star Wars matches speak for himself. We don't know much about Jin. I don't know much about her. I don't know if she is in a fan league player coming up. You know, I know Sam picked her up for this tournament. Are you studying extra Lord of the Rings or Star Wars just in case? Are you trying to find some game tape on Jin? Because, I mean, the game tape for Alex is there. He might know, you know, does he know Star Trek? Does he know, you know, DC movies, MCU? He might have some sneaky stuff. We've seen his strengths showcased in the best way possible. Are you nervous about this next one? Now, like, you know, you've taken the monkey off your back with Saul. You proved to Kate that maybe you should have been in that, like, playing for the Den in this tournament. And me and Kate have had those discussions as well. But you did what you needed to do. You got this win. You got this win. So now you're doing what you need to do. You're looking for the next competitor. What are you thinking coming up with Alex or Jen?
Yeah, I'm not too concerned regarding Alex or Jen. There is a little bit of game tape on Jen if you count the fan leagues as game tape. But yeah, I'm not too concerned until she can really come in here and prove herself. Obviously, Alex is a Star Wars champion, but that's all he really is, a Star Wars champion. Yeah, he's proven that he knows certainly more than you at Lord of the Rings and Middle Earth.
Wow.
Again, maybe not the highest bar. But so what? Maybe he has.
Sorry, two, Brandon. We both struggle with 5-point answers. It's okay.
He has two. I'm sorry, Ben. I was talking. He has two, maybe three strong categories out of the eight main categories in Intergeekdom. So, I mean, I'm not really worried. It's going to take a perfect storm for that idiot to beat me. So.
Wow, that's a strong statement. I wouldn't call a champion of another division an idiot. That seems like you're poking the bear a little bit too. Because if you think he's not studying all those multiple categories, and Lord knows he's been tweeting about it, that kind of shows a little bit of ill preparation on your part if you're not taking him seriously.
Well, I'm not taking him seriously. I don't underestimate any opponent, but at the same time, you got to look at the game tape. Like you said, you got to look at what's been given to me. And if he doesn't spin Star Wars or Middle Earth, this match is going to be over real fast. Guarantee it.
Okay. You think he only has to spin two categories, and if he doesn't, he's dead. Fascinating. Yeah. And why are you crapping on the fan leagues? I mean, Robert Parker came out of the fan leagues, and he's pretty much a heralded rookie.
Didn't Smets come out of the fan leagues? And yeah, Chance, yeah. And Paul?
And a lot of people say you've beaten a bunch of nobodies and a rookie. So, like, you're not that far above the fan leagues. How can you look so down on the fan leagues?
Well, I wouldn't say Smets came from the fan leagues. He cut his teeth. He got his reps in the fan leagues after he hilariously failed his audition to be in the Schmodown the first time around.
Wow.
So it's like, it's in the name. It's the fan leagues. They don't know what they're doing. They like to pretend that they're serious and they're independent and they're all on their own and they're so good. But I mean, come on, they're just ripping us off and we let them. It's like,
who's us? Who's us, kid? Slow down with the us stuff. You win a title, then you can say us. Don't be saying us just yet. Anyway, let's get ready to talk Schmodown podcast. Donated said, Brandon, great job with that win over Saul. So they're giving you some love there, the Let's Get Ready podcast. Do you care if podcasts like what you've done? Yeah, weren't you in the fan leagues? Were you in the fan leagues, Hannah?
I did exactly what Smets did, minus the failing the audition thing.
So you were in the fan leagues, and now you're crapping on them.
Yeah, instead of auditioning, he just carried Ben Bateman's briefcase around for a month.
Whoa,
and
whoa. So I remember the intern. Ben claims that was only for one day. I don't know what the truth is on that. Are you okay with Ben not claiming that you were part of his initial team?
I don't care what Ben claims or doesn't claim. I'm above Bateman. I mean, he's not even here to defend himself. What's he doing? Come on. Okay. You want to talk, Ben? I'm right here. You invite me onto your show and then you leave?
Wow. Come on. Yeah. Okay. All right. Fair.
Thanks for the invite, I guess. And no, to your point, John, I don't care what these fan podcasts have to say. Love what I'm doing. Hate what I'm doing. The Let's Get Ready to Talk Schmodown guys, Justin Hamilton. I'm still never coming on your podcast because I just don't care. I have better things to do.
Yeah. You should come on the Ultimate Schmodown show. That's a new show that just started. Fantastic new podcast. You should come on that show. You get better.
Everyone take a shot.
You get better interviews and better questions. Yeah. I'm just producing. I'm not on. I'm just saying it's good stuff. Okay, Ben, you got a question for
him? So Brandon, so are you doing anything different to study for this tournament? Because, you know, Intergeekdom matches, you know, when we're filming happen once a week, you know, you get a little bit more notice and you never know who you're going to play. You've gone against Chandru, before this, you went against Chandru the last two matches and now he's got a title shot. So you went against a really good player, but now you're going against like the best of the best. Like everyone's in one room outside of Chandru and Smets who are, you know, got to play their title match. And then we're playing the winner of that. Are you doing anything different to study or are you just grinding out the same routine over and over? Like, what are you doing different for the tournament, if anything?
Well, obviously, I don't want to give away exactly what I'm doing. I'm not one of those competitors that likes to parade around what they're studying, how they're studying. I like to play it pretty close to the chest. But I'd like to say I'm going about studying the same way I've always gone. But this time around, maybe I'm focusing those same tools, those that same mindset, but in other areas where I feel like maybe I need to improve upon.
Mm-hmm. Got it. Oh, got it.
So you're saying there are areas where you're not as strong as you think you should be. There are weaknesses in your game, is what you're admitting right now.
I mean, there's weaknesses in everyone's game, John. You should know that as much as anybody.
Well, I can't see over my four titles, kid. Someday you'll get there, but keep going. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, so I mean, that's basically just what I'm doing. I'm just trying to focus on areas where I can improve, because let's be honest, I'm this big arrogant guy that you all think I am. I know that I have areas to improve upon. I'm an imperfect human, just like all of you. But I know
that's what I'm doing. Before I boot you out of here,
we should bring Molly's comment in. I think should bring Molly's comment in.
Yeah, that was nice to know. Me and Alex didn't have to audition and do fan leaks to play. They just know we're that good.
Woo! Wow!
I mean, shot. No, there's no lie there. But yikes. Brandon, getting back, Molly's amazing comment derailed my train of thought. Oh, we asked Alex the same question. Is there anybody you are just chomping at the bit to get at? Whether, you know, is it Robert Parker? Is it, you know, Barbarian? Is it Kalinowski? Yeah. You know, you started out with the match you needed to win. The guy that replaced you, you got him out of the way. So that's got to feel good. But is there anybody like an established, I mean, granted, Robert's only had one match, but you don't give much credit to the fan leagues. It seems like everybody else is hyping him up. Do you just desperately want to play anybody in this tournament outside of obviously Smets and your revenge against Chandru?
I mean, as always, I'll play anyone they put in front of me. I'm not going to run away from a fight. No matter what rumors spread on this show or any other show might lead you to believe, but I'm ready to play Mike Kalinowski on this side of the tournament, on the side of the bracket for sure. I think that would be a lot of fun. I actually do have a little bit of respect for Mike Kalinowski as a player. I think he's a former champion, you know. He's a decent guy. I think that'd be a lot of fun.
What rumors are you speaking about? Do you want to address them now and kind of shoot
this is backstage.
Down?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I mean,
take a drink.
The story that maybe you were pushing John Rocha a little bit about how I was afraid to play Robert Parker.
Kate said that. Kate said that you were afraid to play Robert Parker. And I take your managers at a word. She's a very honest person. And you sensed it was unfair to play Robert Parker this early in the tournament. And so, you know, Kate saw that you were a little bit hesitant and moved you out of her faction into another faction. And so, I mean, she just walked it back a little bit. But the bones of that story seem to be very true.
I mean, that's
are you saying that didn't happen?
That didn't happen at all.
So you're saying officially you were never offered Robert Parker. Someone wants to hack your phone or your emails. They would say they could find that you were never offered Robert Parker and you never walked away from it. Is that what
I'll tell you right now? I was offered Robert Parker and I did not walk away from it.
You wanted to do it.
Yeah, I wanted to do it and I was ready to do it. And you could ask anyone behind the scenes other than I guess Kate Mulligan
I take your word for it. If you say it's true,
whatever,
if someone wants to find evidence on a tweet or whatever, I respect that, but for now I take your word for it. All right, so
there was a match on the books, obviously, with everything happening with COVID.
Yeah,
it didn't happen, but there was certainly no conversation between me and Kate about playing Robert Parker in the first round, and she just didn't put me in the tournament, period.
Okay. All right,
zero respect for me at all. Right. And then I demanded a trade because I had to get the hell out of there and go somewhere where I was respected.
Wait, you demanded the trade?
I demanded the trade.
Ben, is that true? Ben Goddard, have you heard that? Is that the truth?
I have no inside information about this. Okay. You were there on SCN when I learned I was in the Intergeekdom tournament. So I was just as surprised as everyone because I know, despite what Brandon, who he is as a person, I know how good of a competitor he is, and I was looking forward to seeing Brandon be on my team. I was excited when I got drafted to the Den, and I knew we had, like, granted, Sean played a hell of a game, but he lost to Laura, but I know he's going to come back and be a great Star Wars competitor, and I knew Brandon's a good Intergeekdom competitor, and he proved it. He literally proved it in the only way he could. Like, if he had played Kalinowski or Parker or Barbarian first round, people would still be saying, well, you don't need, and if Saul won, be like, well, they both got to win. Brandon did exactly what he needed to do, and I will give him that credit that he beat the guy. It's like Drew Bledsoe beating Tom Brady. Like, you know, you beat your replacement, and he did it. And for now, like, I'm I'm wondering how Brandon's going to do against Jen or Alex Damon. I don't think he's underestimating them, but I think he's putting too much into just Alex being good at only two categories. And I think a lot of us are. I think a lot of us have seen, like, Alex's resume on Star Wars speaks for itself, and then you see in the Lord of the Rings game as well. But I think we're all underestimating of, like, how deep this guy's knowledge can be. If two categories are that good, he's got more room in his brain for Star Trek or MCU or something like that.
Well, I also think, go ahead, Brandon. Sorry. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, as good as Alex is at those two categories, I'm that good at 5, 6, 7 categories out of the 8. And yeah, like I said, I do have a little bit of work. I do have a little bit of work to go, and I'm going to get there. But I mean, I have twice the knowledge, if not 3 times the knowledge of this guy. Yeah. It's going to take a perfect storm for him to beat me. And I see nothing but blue skies.
Wow. All right. Yeah. Because what you said here, I want to address this before we leave with Brandon. Ben, what you said is an interesting point. Brandon did take Airbus against Saul. Yep. But for that 7-minute promo to really carry weight and change the point of view that people have about Brandon and Hannah, you got to run the tournament. You got to run the gauntlet here. You got to go all the way to the final and even play well in the final. You might not have to win, but you have to at least play well in the final. Do you think you're equipped to do that? And if not, are you going to be able to handle people saying he choked again? People, he couldn't get it done again. Are you going to be able to handle that? And will we see another version of Brandon Hannah again, trying to get people to believe in him again?
I mean, I think you can expect to see me in the tournament finals, 100%. And if for whatever reason you don't, I'm not going anywhere. You're not going to see a new version of me. This is the version. This is me. This is who you're going to see from now on. And I'm not going anywhere. I'm just going to keep coming back and coming back.
Okay.
And I'll never go away.
All right.
All right. Drunk 3PO. Maybe after Alex beats Hannah, he can go back to the fan leagues. They have some great rookies he can continue to beat so he can build a Schmodown career. Ooh. Man, he's just already putting Alex in the next round. I haven't watched that match yet, so I don't know if Alex or beats Jen. So, you know, Alex got to handle his business in the first round. Yeah. So, Brandon, we'll get you out of here with this. The French Taunter. Glad to see Hannah has a shirt on. Thanks for taking 3 points from the den and helping to extend the exchange's lead.
Mm. Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that.
Yeah. Because in the end, that's all you really did, because we know the Droogs aren't going to do anything in this league. And you guys stay in the bottom half of the teams.
Wow. Wow. Strong shots.
Well, we'll see about that.
I mean, it's all right that I have more points than your entire team combined, but no big deal.
All right. Brandon, do you have a promo lined up for this match coming up that you've already been thinking about and germinating in your mind?
That I've been germinating in my mind. Oh, yeah. I don't know. I think, you know, who is Kevin Smets? Get out.
Hannah would get blown out of the fan leagues. Back to bar trivia for you, bub. Wow. Strong statement from the Smets, from the champion.
You think the champion would have a little more class, but I guess not.
But I think the champion, the fact that he's even commenting, says that he must see something in your victory against Saul, wouldn't you, Brandon?
I mean, I would be a little afraid of me if I were him too, and he should be lucky that Chandru won that last match. He should feel very lucky that it wasn't me, because I would be taking that belt clean off his shoulder.
That's one last thing. Do you think Chandru wins this thing, or do you think Smets is, when we finally get to see this match, do you got Chandru or do you got Smets in this one?
Oh, I've got Smets. Come on.
Okay. All right.
Smets and I, we have our differences right now. But you want to talk about someone I have zero respect for at all?
Yeah.
It's Chandru Dhandapani.
Even after he handed you your butt twice, you still don't have respect for him?
Wow.
No. Okay. All right.
So we keep saying the last thing, but how I just got to ask, Brandon, like, I have my disagreements with Chandru, and how he handled himself after your second match. And, you know, you were on my team at the time, and I took that very personally. But how do you not give at least competitive respect for someone that TKO'd you twice? Like, what is it that you just can't find anything in Chandru's game to respect him for?
I mean, Chandru's good. Don't get me wrong. I do think that we are on a very similar level. And if things have gone a little differently in those last two matches, it could have very easily gone the other way, where I would have been 2-0 and he would have been 0-2. But it went in his favor, and it did. But I mean, it's Kevin Smets. The guy doesn't miss.
Hmm. You just said he missed in his first audition. So He has been. Just something to think about.
All right. Thank you so much for being here, Brandon.
Thank you, Brandon.
And thank you for keeping the promos under 7 minutes and staying off script. We really appreciate it, bud. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good luck in your next match.
Brought it in. But,
yeah. I appreciate
good
it.
Seeing you, man.
Have a good day,
seeing
brother.
You again. Take care.
So we had Brandon on just now, and you know, Ben's still on his business call. And you know, I like that slow drawl that Brandon's got. I like the thoughtfulness behind all of his words. Like he's taken his I don't want to give him Hannibal Lecter quite yet, but he's not that calculating, he's not that good yet. But if he gets that belt with this same attitude. But you know what? We got a little palate cleanser waiting in the wings. A guy that just exudes positive energy.
Class.
Just amazing things. Yes, Lucas, it is time to tune back in. We appreciate you coming back. but this is a guy that just spews Star Wars knowledge all while drinking a beer or sipping on some whiskey. Yeah. He just had a perfect game and was one word away from at least continuing, if not winning, in overtime. And that is Mr. Joseph Luke in the Last Jedi Scrimshaw.
Hello. Hello. My beer and I say hello.
Oh, perfect. On brand. And we love to see it. So Joseph, just seeing in your exit interview after that match, like I don't even have to ask how you're feeling about it, but how was the match for you? Like, were you just getting more excited? You know, like perfect round. Andrew gets all 10. Like after Andrew got all 10 without going multiple choice once, were you nervous at all? Or were you just like, hell yes, let's go.
No, I was definitely very, very excited to keep going because I really wanted, you know, there's always the competition with the other player, but there's always the just competition with yourself. And in the other games I've played, I have made errors that aren't so much about knowledge, but are errors about the gameplay of Schmodown. Yeah. My very first game and then my championship against Alex. If I had asked for a multiple choice, I would have tied or won. So I was really going into the second round, just not wanting to make any gameplay errors. So I was really proud of myself for that.
When Alex and you, like, listen, you get to that third round, and those are some, you know, incredibly difficult questions, and you both nail them, and you walk into this final sudden death situation. Both Ben and I were pontificating earlier or speculating earlier what happened here in this answer of yours. Did you think that because in other matches you had answered in the spirit of the answer correctly, you were given those points, that you had the right answer here with Luke? Or do you legitimately thought you were answering the right answer for this question?
I thought I had the best answer that I was going to pull in that moment. I did not have any thought that I was going to slide by on a lack of specificity. You know, I had watched, I did hear you guys pontificating earlier, and, you know, I played the games where it was a little loosey-goosey here and there, and it was a little bit like, you know, even sometimes we're like, it was a quote question, and somebody got everything but one word, and I know those days are gone. super gone. So there wasn't any thought of like, oh, I can slide by. And I'd watched Andrew's games and knew that, that he was a challenger. He's a good opponent, and he would absolutely challenge if I had a lack of specificity. So it was not about trying to slide by.
Okay.
Is this game like, was it still fun for you, Joseph? Was it still like, you know, because the game has changed to a more competitive, like we're going to more sports, because, you know, before the Schmodown was like, hey, let's play some movie trivia and we'll see who's good at, like, you know, I was watching Roka, your three-way match with you, Riley, and Dan.
Yeah.
You guys all missed a question. You're all like, you know, that's how the game goes.
Those were the now,
days. And that's the thing. Now, Roka would be throwing chairs and saying, shut the F up, everybody.
That's true.
So, to be fair, like, are you still are you going to come back, Joseph? Or are we going to see you back when we have another Star Wars tournament or another Star Wars match? Is there going to be, you know, because you're one of the veterans in this league, like you and Ken have like been day one Star Wars competitors. Yeah. Are we going to see you back?
Oh, yeah, I'd love to come back. It's always fun for me. I really, the vast majority of the studying and the knowledge I either just have or enjoy getting more knowledge. Some of it gets a little tedious when you get into, you know, the number of different things in Star Wars that are reactor something or thermal something gets a little tedious of like, or power something or coupling something. Like, I don't give it. All right, I'll remember it for the trivia. It's always fun. And the main thing for me is, I say it as a joke in some of the promos, but I seriously mean it. Where else is somebody going to ask me even to name five Jedi who are standing around in one particular scene, much less give a damn and like applaud, you know?
Like, I'm like a little kid. Your bank teller, is this a checking or savings? Well, if you know, there's five Jedi in the throne room. When...
Right, you know, it's totally like a little kid. Like, you know, when a little kid is, he just walks up to you or a little girl and they just want to tell you their five favorite sandwiches, you know? Yeah. It's like, that's the way I feel about Star Wars. I just like, can I list Jedi? Great.
Like, outside of the Shmodown, you feel like the kid from Jerry Maguire. The human brain weighs 6 pounds.
That's good, Joseph. That's good. Yeah but no, I thought that question, when that question was asked, I could tell in your eyes there was almost a certain kind of joy in that question even coming up in the Shmodown. And then you methodically going through them, and you didn't even have to take the extra 20 seconds. Like, you took about five, embraced the joy of that question, and then named them all. And it was incredible to watch, to be honest with you. So, I mean, I don't know how anyone can walk away from this match and not have even more respect for you as a competitor in the Star Wars division, because, like, any little thing was going to end up turning the match one way or another, and you could have won this thing absolutely on the next question or the third question. It was all there to be had, and I think people see you and the relaxed approach and the bourbon, and they don't understand how competitive you actually are for all the chill stuff, Joseph. I know outside of the Shmodown as well, in life, you are driven to achieve a lot of things, man. And so seeing that bleed into the Star Wars, I always kind of smile or smirk at people who think you're not as dialed in as other people.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, the philosophy of Star Wars is that the dark side is always there. The greatest Jedi is pulled to the darkness. It is an everyday battle to choose the light. And that's one of the reasons that I choose to approach something that's a competition, like the Shmodown, with like, let's embrace the light. It's about me. It's not about crushing anybody else. Because I got the dark side. And if I let it in with years of combi experience, I would become a monster a-hole. That's not who I want to be.
I was going to say, when Christian announced your record and you only have one win, I couldn't believe that, because you've been there so many times. Like, I realize, and, you know, literally, like, and that what John was saying, like, seeing like your wry smile when you got that five pointer, and then just seeing you and Andrew go back and forth, and then your exit interview was great. But is there a little frustration that you were one steal? Like, I remember Alex got the how does BB-8 recognize Rey or Finn, whatever that question was. Yeah. That was the difference in the game for the belt, for the live event, and literally a one word hatred was your one word away from continuing this match. Is there a little frustration that you're like, I'm this good, I'm this close, I'm coming back?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Like, total honesty. Like, the next tournament, I would love to, I saw other people joking about it. Hey, give me some rookies to just smash. That would be great fun. Yeah. I would love to do that. Almost every game I've ever played, somebody at the table has been a huge, huge heavy hitter. I've gone straight to a championship. No. And I like saying Star Wars stuff. And, you know, honestly, like, everybody's competing is really good. But some of the matches that have already come and gone, I knew every answer. You know, the match right after me, I literally knew every answer. Yeah. So definitely there is that frustration of like, man, I'd really love to continue. And I would have loved to win. I'm really, really happy for Andrew, because I know it means a ton to him. And I know it would have been harder for him having three losses. So, like, the fact that I'm happy for Andrew softens it. But of course, I would have liked to win. And you know, a team signs me and I want to do my best for them. So,
right,
definitely frustrating.
Got the super chat from Rasten King. There's a much more pleasant place than the not man. That's a low bar, Rasten King, but you're very true. But yeah. I see this in the chat as well, real quick, John, right here. Yeah. Here we go.
No way.
There's no intro match. You want to get in the Star Wars League.
Yeah, that's true. I am a rookie. You absolutely destroy and carve up in the Star Wars League. Yes.
I would love to play.
Make it happen. It's on the books, people.
Give me 3 months. Give me 3 months.
All right.
It's going to take some time. You know, Joseph and I have known each other for a number of years. You know, I remember the fresh-faced kid I met years ago. Look at this beard. Like, what is the what is the motivation? Because all of a sudden, you seem like an elder statesman as a writer and host and comedian. And now, of course, Star Wars Smodown competitor. Like, what was the motivation behind the beard? Was it the COVID situation or just, you know, you liked it? Okay.
Yeah, it was just just the lockdown,
here's,
man.
Here's the best comment of the day. Here's the best comment. You gotta get Scrimshaw's ass for you.
Hello. Hello.
I don't know. Real quick for context, Joseph, Roka has this amazing like sound bite because he's been talking about coming in the Star Wars League for so long. He was like, I want Damon's ass so bad. And then he follows it with so bad. And so we've used that for so many things. But go ahead, Joe. I had to pull that up because that's the best comment I've seen all day, Alex.
Yeah.
But anyway, go ahead, Joseph. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. The beard was just a way to externalize the lockdown. Like I felt, you know, I feel sort of lucky being a human who can grow facial hair. Like I can externalize the trauma and not everyone can. So I'm going to.
Yeah, what's it been like for you with this with the COVID situation, man? Are you working consistently still? Are you working on, you know, are you writing? Are you doing all this? Because the stuff you do outside of the Schmodown as well that, you know, like gets blessed with your talent. What else are you on right now?
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. Do the podcast. I have the Obsessed podcast and, of course, Force Center with Ken Napsok and Jennifer Landa. And yeah, I'm busy writing away. I'm a writer for a show on Adult Swim called Tig Tone. It's a great fantasy comedy show. Yes. And then I got a bunch of different scripts at different levels of pitching or shopping or currently writing. So between the podcast and the writing, like I had to make a real choice to go, ooh, the Schmodown is really, really intense, especially for Star Wars. So if I'm going to do this, I'm going to set aside some time and really dedicate some time.
Yeah, and we've seen other people. Hey, Ben, what's up, man? We've seen other people have their significant others help them in their study. I know Sarah, your wife, is a big fan of yours. Was she helping you like the Damons were? Were you being helped by Sarah in this study situation? Or she's like, Star Wars, you can take that and go someplace else. What was she like?
No, she's such a sweetheart about it. You know, we rewatched a bunch of the movies together in our normal like viewing time of, hey, we sit down for dinner and we watch something that was like all Star Wars movies. And, you know, I was actually telling her, like, man, everybody else, like, I'm not complaining, Sarah, you're like the greatest spouse ever, but everybody else, they're in the world. This is what they do. And like, you go out and make money and you're a dancer and like, I can't complain. But like, so then she was like, I'm going to help. So it's really helpful. She's been trying to come up with like random questions and just surprise me at random times, which is really great. And as we were watching the movies, she would write down, she got in the groove and she would write down great questions, especially some of the ones that suck, like the numbers, right? Of how many nostrils the character has and how many security guards are standing where. So she did a great job helping me prepare for this.
Well, one. I'd like a Scrimshaw's versus Damon's exhibition match down the road. I'll put that in there. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Ben.
I'm curious to know, Joseph, with the Star Wars League, obviously being the league that you've really shown in, you know, and there's so much expectation that leads to one of these matches, but there aren't that many matches.
Mm-hmm.
When you go in and you play as well as you did, is that like just the emotional balloon is so popped at the end of that? I mean, I would think that win or lose, the emotional balloon is sort of popped because there's so few matches, but especially after that kind of a loss, that devastating of a loss.
I mean, the loss was a bummer, but I felt it was cushioned by the fact that I did well, and I was proud of that, and I was happy for Andrew. The balloon always pops because I enjoy really, really getting all the knowledge back in my head, and I enjoy just getting trained up for trivia, just having nothing to do with Star Wars, just that recall ability that you don't need in day-to-day life. And every time I've trained up, I'm always like, come on, I'm trained up. I want to keep doing it. So
I want to keep doing it.
I would love
to
do some version of a tournament where you're going to play a little longer, some version of a tournament where maybe even it's, you know, best 3 out of 5 where you can play a few more games. I would love to stay in the groove.
Would you ever do what Damon is doing and take a shot at IG? I mean, and forgive me if you guys asked any of this stuff.
No,
you're good.
No, I've watched some of the inner geekdoms, and usually when I just play along, I can do about 70% just off of being a fan, and I know that's not enough, and I just know I don't have the time to become the expert I need to be. Back in the day, like if they wanted to have, like, I don't know, it sounds weirdly insulting, but a kiddie league that was like you've agreed, you've signed a paper, you're not studying, this is back to just like people who happen to watch movies and kind of like them. Wow. If there was ever like a that kind of display for Intergeekdom, it'd be great fun. But I can't compete. I don't have the time to compete at the level people are competing at.
So Scrimshaw wants to walk in there like Anakin and kill all the younglings. That's what he wants.
Exactly.
To do.
Right. Exactly what his manager is saying too. Let him destroy an array of Padawans.
So I would love to know what you guys think about this because this is something that I've been thinking about. I know we were talking about it a minute ago with Alex Damon, but the idea of how much time it takes league to league to take somebody from a very, very entry level position to actually competitive. And I'm not saying take somebody from like entry level to being the champion, but being able to compete and win one or two matches in a tournament. And I think league to league, like, I agree with you, John. I watched the Star Wars tournament this year and I thought to myself, I think with 60 days, I could win this title. Like, wow. That's what I thought.
Hi. Like, you were, did you go smoke something in this business meeting you had just now?
Let's make it clear. 60 days, if you're like, you know, you're quarantined, you don't have to work from home.
Right, right, right.
You know, that
this
kind of time.
Came to be quarantined, obviously. Right, this right. Came to me in living in this corner of my apartment for the last, three months. But I'm not saying that to throw down the gauntlet because I'm not going to do it. I don't think that's the thing I'm going to do. And I've already pretty much backed away from the idea of ever doing Intergeekdom because I think I would lose every important relationship in my life. I think it would literally ruin my life. But okay, so I believe a really talented player, somebody with a good mind for it, could do Star Wars in 2 months if they really, like, really did it. Now, with IG, I used to think something similar. I don't anymore. What's your guys' opinion? If you wanted to take somebody who's a very good singles or teams player and make them championship level in IG, how much time do you think you need?
Who are you asking, Joseph?
All of us?
I'd just love to know what you guys think, just based on observing it.
I already said it's a year. To me, it's at least a year. Then you can be ready. Yeah.
Like, I've, you know, really studying for Intergeekdom has made me have a new appreciation for it. Like, you know, I've played on the sidelines, you know, even last summer, you know, while I was working, you know, at the studio and stuff like that. And, you know, I was like, oh, I think I can hang. And then just seeing, like, you're watching this movie and you're like, oh, Iron Man. Okay. Credits open, directed, scored, all that stuff. 2008. Okay. Okay. He's driving an Audi. There's four other people in the Humvee. Oh, what's the name of that? The first soldier that dies in the prelude scene. Damn it. Okay. So, what kind of phone does he have? And that's literally the first 30 seconds of the film. Yeah, I can't even imagine what Joseph does. I was going to ask that. It's like, how do you even like start to study for Star Wars? Because like I said to Molly and Alex, is like, you can watch the Intergeekdom movies. You have to watch them a lot to know them, but you can watch them to learn them. Like everyone's holding up books, and that's the difference. I don't think y'all are saying 2 months, 3 months, like at least six for Star Wars, at least six.
And I think with Star Wars, you know, you are all much better experts on the rest of the Schmodown. But for me, the Star Wars questions, the way they get asked, the way they can be phrased, it helps to just be immersed and have it be a part of your life, because, you know, the names and the numbers you can study, but then when you actually play the game, it's not names and numbers that come up as often. It's things like the logic of a scene or being able to really truly hear the question correctly that trip you up, or replay the movie in your mind. And even some of them with Star Wars, a lot of it is you can watch the movies, and because of the nature of Star Wars, I know this has been discussed with things like, you know, Ewoks aren't named in the film, Tatooine isn't named in A New Hope. There's a ton of stuff that comes up that has never been in a movie.
Never.
Chancellor Valorum's first name is not in a movie. Stuff. There's a ton of stuff in the actual movies that has never been asked about. But stuff that's general Star Wars knowledge gets asked all the time.
Well, I think that's the key. And I think that's why Ben and I find our calling in the singles and the teams division, because we feel an organic connection to these movies. And I think with Star Wars and Intergeekdom, you have to have this kind of organic love for it, right? To be able to survive. And I think what Joseph says is absolutely correct. You can study all the names and numbers and the dates and all that stuff that you want, all the numbers of the droids, all that stuff. But there's going to be a question or a couple of questions in a critical moment that will have that will require you to understand the movie, understand what's being presented, and that organic love of it will stick with you because you remember a certain scene or a moment or an exchange or whatever, because you love it so much that comes into play and could be the difference between you winning and losing. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I thought one thing I felt a lot about, John, you know, mentioned this is so you were in season one and season two of the Schmodown when it was a little bit less defined. It was back in the AfterBuzz days and it was not the same game, but even so you were still competing in those early days, which means from the time you started to the time you won a title, a singles title, the title took you 3.5 years. Took me about 2.5, almost 3 years in the league to get there, right? So you start, you enter, you have this organic connection to movies, which is where you came from. Same with me, right? But I think about training somebody who's not at that level. Somebody maybe you take somebody who does have a good base like you had or like I had, and you say, I'm going to train you up to be competitive. So Joseph, if you were going to take somebody who's seen every Star Wars movie, they've seen all the movies, they like them, they can talk to you about who, you know, Bosk is. They recognized IG-88 in The Mandalorian because maybe they had the toy. They're at that level.
See you in 3 months, Ben.
My point being, if you were going to take a player who liked Star Wars and you said, how much time do I need to train this person to win? How much time do you think you would need? I'm just curious to know.
Yeah, I mean, if they're starting from a strong base, I think a couple months. Yeah, because I think the time thing is at this point, you really have to watch the movies, because the questions that trip people up are not things that you can study unless you're literally studying, unless your studying is literally writing down every line of the film, which I suspect is going on with a couple, you know, I showed you my Yoda book. It's very cute. Look at it. And sometimes I think that's the stuff that is both a gift and a curse to know the films really, really well. Because sometimes you just need to be able to replay a scene, and you need to also be able to recognize what is the, you know, you have to watch them so differently, and you have to spend so much time watching them to pause and write down questions. Then you have to watch them for just like major plot beats and that kind of thing. It involves watching them so much.
Yeah.
Did you guys already ask a little bit about the final question? Is that something you talked about when I
went? Yeah. And he's, you know, and Joseph answered, you know, for him, it was, he thought he'd gotten the question right. He thought he'd said the right thing.
He said he wasn't sure of the answer. That was his best.
That was his best attempt. Exactly.
I'll tell you what happened, because I know there's some curiosity and it was not, I had been watching earlier, Ben, and I think, tired is a great guess, but it was not about being tired. In fact, I would love to do an Iron Person match, because once I'm in the zone, I like staying in the zone. I would love to do that. For me, it is how my brain is wired. My brain is wired much more on narrative and themes. And as soon as I heard, what does Vader, I can't remember if the question was believe or say, can defeat him.
Yeah.
My brain already has to twist itself around. If it was, here's a quote, you know, what did Vader say Luke should use to destroy him?
Gotcha.
I would get hatred in a second. But my mind starts spinning in. Well, Vader didn't. This is literally what went through my mind. Vader didn't believe anything could destroy him. The Emperor tells him that Luke could destroy them. And to me, that line is totally about a manipulation that Vader is doing to Luke. And that is the way my brain processes it is a weakness in the trivia contest for me. I can memorize names and numbers, but if in 15 seconds, my mind wastes the first 5 seconds by thinking through something narratively, I'm in trouble. And that's what happened with that, is I knew Luke was the spirit of the answer, but I just didn't even recognize it as a quote.
I think that's what happens to so many players when they answer, right? Ben, you know, and all of us who've competed know, I'm sure Ben Goddard, you're realizing that too. Sometimes you can overthink a question and you can be like, well, what are they looking for here? And you know, with a one pointer, there's no multiple choice. So you kind of have to take your chance with whatever you ultimately land on in your mind as you think to be the answer that they're looking for based on how the question is phrased. So that's always another part of this that a lot of people don't factor into when they're watching from the sidelines.
I mean, I always brought up, because we were talking about it on my stream, like other people's and stuff like that. It's the same thing that happened in my first teams match, where it was like, Dante asks Randall what his favorite Star Wars movie is. What is Randall's response?
Right.
And Rachel says Empire. And people are like, oh, well, that's not the full title of the movie.
Right, right.
But his response in the movie is Empire. So what's the correct answer? Like, are they both correct? Is only one or the full title correct? And so I get exactly what Joseph is talking about. It's like, what's the spirit of the question? And then what are they asking?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's going to be the big thing going forward. And that was what I was kind of talking about at the, in my exit interview there.
I keep calling it exit interview. I really got
Yeah, like I there was a moment where I thought of challenging Andrew early on, not because he was wrong, but because what level of pedantic challenge is the way to win this game? In the first round is a super easy question of who does Vader tell Jared Gerard is less forgiving, you know, that not as forgiving as he is. And I answered the Emperor just in case. That's a character who has a lot of different names and titles. Answered the Emperor just in case, because even though it wasn't presented as a quote question, that's quote.
What it said.
The Emperor is not as forgiving as I am. And Andrew answered Palpatine. And there, I had a brief second of, should I challenge it? I was like, I don't want to be that guy.
But you could mean Rey now. Nowadays, you could mean Rey.
You could mean Palpatine. Yeah, and then later, Andrew answered the question about who does Luke call for first in Cloud City Weathervane, and Andrew answered it, Ben Kenobi. And he doesn't call for Ben Kenobi, and I assume, because Andrew is so sharp, so smart, he was trying to be the most precise, so nobody accused him of saying Luke is calling for Ben Quadraneros. But that's just an example of two moments where Andrew, obviously incredibly sharp, neither of those answers were wrong. But if the game becomes about being pedantic, how much are we going to challenge variations of correct answers?
I think that's a great point.
Yeah. And I'm not saying that for my challenge. Andrew's correct it for my question.
Right. And then Ryan Kramer asked in the chat about, you know, the shield generator question. Did you watch the second match, Joseph?
I did.
How was your feeling on that one? Because that one was like, seemed to be splitting hairs.
That was pushing the... Yeah,
that was one of those. Are you, and this is a question of how the questions are constructed. Do we want to start being sure to say we're asking for the correct question? And I did. I just did happen to know that one, that it was, the line was literally energy shield. But that's a perfect example of like, well, the question was phrased, I believe, as, you know, where do they redirect power? Well, you would direct it to a shield generator is where the power would literally go. So if you're not asking for a quote, I can see an argument that just saying the shield generator is correct.
Right. And this is the pact we've walked into as competitors here, because all love to the writers in the Schmodown.
The questions they've written for this tournament alone have been insanely good.
They're phenomenal. So like, but because the level of competition has increased so much, we're going to see these little moments of nitpicking a word or nitpicking the spirit of a question or nitpicking the technical specificity, as Joseph just said, to a generator versus what they were actually looking for. These are the things that are going to come up more often than not. It does not mean that you're denigrating the question writers. It means you're saying there is some room here to wiggle, and we're going to have to rely on judges to make the right decisions or the correct calls in those moments and be willing to take the hits for making those calls. That's the always the exchange with asking for the level of play to increase. The level of dedication from the players will increase. Therefore, the level of specificity will increase, and therefore the level of anger could increase or frustration could increase when a certain question is asked and an answer is accepted that they don't think is 100% specifically correct. So,
well, let me ask you, Joseph, because I know we've just got you here for another minute before we wrap the show today. You mentioned that you love the trivia recall aspect, and obviously you played a perfect game. You lost by having a slightly less correct answer, which is crazy. Never seen that before. Is this something, and I don't think we would see another Star Wars opportunity to have matches row in a row until probably season 8, but I could be wrong about that. It could be towards the end of the season. Is this something that you want to get back into? You still want to win that title? Is this still something you're
in? Yeah. Okay, I still love doing the Star Wars. Love to hear that.
Yeah.
And I guess my last question to you is, after facing Dimmalanta, and I don't know if that's the player that you thought was showing up, or if you got the player you expected, where's your money? Where's your money for who comes out of this thing?
Ooh, that's difficult. I really believe in Molly. I really think that it is clear that Laura and Andrew, I think, have taken that studying to a really another level with the amount of time they're spending watching and rewatching the movies, which I think is really the key. So, I think one of those three. No disrespect to my beloved friend Ken Knapsack. He might pull it out. He might pull it out. But he and I have the same strengths and weaknesses. We remember the things that we love. We've got all the names and all the numbers memorized. But sometimes quotes and narrative logic will trip us both up. So if anybody perceives that as an insult to Ken, it is also an insult that I'm giving to myself.
Ken, talk about Force Center, man. Where can people find your show?
Yeah, you can find us at Force Center Pod on Twitter. Our main main podcast location is Anchor, but it's on all the places that you can find podcasts. And then personally, you can find me Twitter and Instagram at Joseph Scrimshaw.
So do you have Ken winning tomorrow against Ace, Joseph? Because he's going up against his former Padawan from Force Center.
I do. I love Ace. I think Ace is strong. I think Ken has an edge because this game, as you all know, is not just about knowledge. It is about the experience of playing the game. And I do think that there are moments where just being able to interpret a question or just having been in the hot seat enough times so you get that flash of, oops, I don't know that answer, and not give it into fear, but just calmly thinking through what the answer is. Ken has so much more experience being in the hot seat. I think he has a little bit of an edge on Ace.
Yeah.
I like it. I like it.
Love it.
Respect.
We have one here from Drunk C3PO, a super chat. Scrimshaw, did you know the correct answer to the shield question?
Yeah, I brought it up. Yeah, we were talking about that, the shield generator answer.
Yeah. Gotcha. I missed that.
Yeah, I gotcha.
All right, my friend. Well, thank you so much for coming by, Joseph. We really appreciate you hanging out on the
show.
Thank
you so much, Joseph.
And, thanks, Joseph.
That was absolutely an incredible match.
Thank you, both. High, sir.
Wow. Well, packed show today. I'm glad I was able to get back in here. Yeah, I know. So entertaining. So entertaining.
Right, what a great way to end the show. Like,
right.
I think Joseph just seems to be on every week and just like the last 10 to 15 minutes and just like give us like this positive energy and drink beer with us. Cause that was so refreshing.
Right. Cause he's, cause he's not busy. He totally has time to show up.
Yeah. He totally has time. Like, take 10, 15 minutes out of the day just to make up feel better.
Yeah, exactly.
But no. Hannah's mad at you, Ben. Hannah's mad that you were not here. He goes, he invites me on his show. Doesn't he have the guts to show up and confront me? So maybe you got to figure out.
He called out in his video because I was definitely mentioned in that video. So
you were? All right. Just want to make sure.
And Hannah can, you can sit and spin, my friend.
Wow.
I had an important meeting I had to get to.
I know.
Look at this. No cussing. No cussing, everybody. So I think, again, I put it on Joseph. Joseph's our good luck charm.
No cussing.
Coincidence. No Kaiser. Yeah, that helps a lot too.
All right. So I guess my last question for you guys before we get out of here is this: John, what's the reality of you ever taking an actual crack at Star Wars? We talked about it a lot today. I want to get the real answer from you. When and if.
Now, I am a very organic person, so I legitimately want to take my crack at Star Wars. I've already started watching the original trilogy on Disney Plus while I'm at the house and have already started like kind of slowly opening the door to it. But to be honest with you, the singles belt is still my obsession with I've got this Ethan match coming up. And if I am lucky enough to take care of business and the gameplay, the game goes in my favor, then I will have a titanic task in taking on my tag team partner for the title. And I'm telling you something right now, winning the singles title for the third time would mean so much to my legacy. And at that point, whatever happens after that, then I can, and then of course the tag team belt against Corruption is going to be hell of a thing. So to me, that's my obsession right now, playing my way through both of those situations. And then after that, I think I take a moment and see where I'm at. And if unfortunately I lose both, which I hope I don't, then at that point my schedule opens up a little bit, and then I start to see where I can get into Star Wars. But it wouldn't be till next year, obviously. But that I definitely have an interest and a desire, just because so many people don't believe I can't do it. And nothing motivates me more than people believing I can't do something. I love it, especially if it's from the same people who tell other people not to doubt them, but they have no problem doubting you. So I love to prove a lot of people wrong who doubt me. It's something I live for. So yes, it's a very real possibility. That's the answer to your question.
Season 8. Goddard, two questions for you. A, any Streamlabs? B, are you ever going to take a crack at Star Wars? As somebody who's been doing the IG thing.
We...
We're good on Streamlabs. Thank you guys for all the questions today. We got a lot of super chats today, so that was awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
I don't know. I don't think so. I think, you know, Inner Geekdom doing, you know, we call it three divisions because it is, you know, teams and singles, but the, the singles and teams are is the same thing. It's the same knowledge. You're just playing with someone else and like, okay, you know, Ben, you're good at, you know, movie release dates and, you know, action movies and a lot of other things, obviously. So maybe I don't have to study those if you're on my team. Right. But I, you know, we were talking about what it's going to take for Alex to get on Rushmore. I think if Alex even sniffs a belt in Inner Geekdom, he's on Rushmore because the level of deep dive studying you have to do for those two divisions, granted, it's a smaller, but it like, especially for Star Wars, like, cause Star Wars, you're going 100 levels deep compared to Inner Geekdom where you're probably going 50 to 75 maybe.
Yeah.
And so I would really, I'm never going to do Star Wars. I'll try my best in Inner Geekdom. No, yeah. Star Wars, not for me. I love to watch it, but I don't have like Joseph and Ken and Alex and all these guys have just like years of Star Wars obsession and love that they've applied to movie trivia. I think it's hard. Like I like Star Wars quite a bit and I can hang in round one, but that doesn't mean like I'm going to go back and revisit. Okay. Phantom Menace. What kind of ship do Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon Jinn arrive on? What's the name of the droid that greets them? What's the name of the two Nemoidians that are on the ship? Like that's literally just like the first scene of the movie. And those are probably maybe 3-point answers like that. They're not even 5-pointers.
Yeah. You're already making me regret my statements about 60 days. I started getting sick.
You're crazy.
I just started getting sick to my stomach. So okay, excellent. Well, I'm sticking to it though. I'm gonna win that Star Wars belt before I'm done in the Schmodown. I believe I can do it. And it's okay. You know, I don't know if it'll be this season. Maybe I'll have to wait till season 8 because just like you, John, I'm 2 wins away from each of those divisions from retaining the belt. So I have the same drive, that same fire, my friend. And you and I are in that unique position of being, you know, you are the team's champion right now.
Yeah.
You're 2 wins away from that singles belt, the same as me. So I know we want it. I know we both want it.
It's true. Maybe we face each other in the Star Wars division. Wouldn't that be funny to take our rivalry even there?
Easy, Ben. Easy, says Alex. Look, I said it about Inner Geekdom when I was newer in the league and I didn't understand what I was saying. I fully understand what I'm saying. I don't think it's an easy thing. I'm not just some guy walking off the street. That's the thing. When I heard Scrimshaw saying, if you've got a good base, I want a freaking title. I'm allowed to say that in 2 months, if I wanted to study for a division, I believe I could win. Doesn't mean I'm going to. I just believe it. Okay. So, you know, I think I've earned the right. But John, where can the folks find out Raw Nation?
Triple header. Boom. Make it happen.
Yeah. John, talk to me about Outlaw Nation. You've got a show tonight.
Yeah, Spence don't want no smoke. Speaking of Spence, he's my guest tonight on Outlaw Nation. 6 p.m. PT. Me and the Smasher, I'd like to affectionately call him. He is coming on the show with me. We're going to have a lot of fun. 2 hours, maybe 2.5 hours, just talking about his career in the Schmodown, his life, how it's changed, being an IG champion and, you know, dedication and all of the ups and downs, everything like that. We're also going to talk about his life as a child actor. What were some of the crazy stories from that time in his life, you know? And also we're going to jump into his love of Star Wars, because that's something we've been doing, as I said, texting back and forth, competing against each other through every one of these matches as we watch live on Twitch. So we're just going to get into all that, have a lot of fun. You know, it's been a tough last couple of weeks for a lot of us emotionally and in our world and in our country. And, you know, I felt like this week, let's have someone on to have some fun with and relax and just be playful. And Kevin is one of the guys that I've really come to enjoy and love as a friend. So please come and enjoy us tonight, 6 p.m. to about 8:30 p.m. PT. On the Outlaw Nation channel, which is youtube.com/JohnRocaSays. You know where to follow me at The Roca Says on Twitter and on Instagram. And come follow me on Twitch, The Outlaw Nation, all one word, lowercase. Come follow me there as well.
Excellent. And guys, you can go check out Action Industries. We're doing incredible stuff every week there. We got the Inglorious One, Sam Levine, coming this Sunday night, as well as my new thing I'm doing, youtube.com/nerdsinsuits. The main show is a one-on-one interview show. Got some good guests coming on there. And then I have the show called Song from the Scene, where I'm talking about the greatest songs in movie scenes than actually playing those songs. So this week I'm doing Tiny Dancer from Almost Famous, which I'll be honest.
Nice.
It took me two weeks of working on that song before I could actually comfortably record it because the first attempts were awful. And it's the best. I mean, I think it's the single most iconic pop song in a movie that I can actually think of at this point. I feel like if that scene that scene, it made that song one of the most famous Elton John songs ever. So anyway, absolutely, check that out. It premieres tomorrow at 12 noon and tonight for patrons. So thanks everybody for all the support on Nerds and Suits and for the announcement of my original album, which was last weekend. And otherwise,
good stuff.
Thank you all for tuning into the show. This was a great one. I apologize for missing a few minutes in the middle there, but we'll be back same time, same place next week for another episode of Schmodown Backstage. We'll talk a little bit more about that Barbarian win. We'll talk about some of these upcoming matches. I'm excited to talk a little bit more about the Star Wars matches tomorrow. Goddard, thanks as always
for thank you, Ben.
Being here, my good friend. And I will see you guys soon.
Take care, y'all.
Bye, guys.